welcome to another exciting broadcast day.
Well, good morning, Teresa.
Good morning.
Good morning, Dave Damashek.
Hello, Adam.
Good to see you.
Nice to see you.
I like your new attitude, whatever it is.
Well, you know what it is. It's Teresa Strasser. She's outdone herself outfit-wise, boots and skirt again.
Yes.
But black this time.
Dolled up.
Thank you.
Very nice. Very striking. Let's see. Well, where to begin? At the beginning, 866-901-ADAM is the phone number. Vincent Pastore is going to be calling in here from The Sopranos. Saw that last night. Ace Young also
putting in a call. I need to correct this. Frank Vincent's calling in. Vincent
Pastore's
coming.
I'm sorry.
Big pussy.
Yes. I knew something seemed wrong with... it's weird. Vincent Pastore and Frank Vincent. Maybe it's early. It almost sound like the same name to me. Maybe it's the Vincent... Maybe one guy's name ends in Vincent and the other guy's begins in that.
Exactly.
Anyway, Frank Vincent will call in from The Sopranos, Phil Leotardo, and then Vincent Pastore will be in studio. Ace Young is calling in. Ozzy has a review. Landon Donovan, the soccer star, is calling in. So plenty of show. Mike Birbiglia, a very funny stand-up, is coming in as well. I mentioned Ozzy's going to review The Sentinel. So quickly... Went out to Costco yesterday with Jimmy Kimmel. Dave got you a gift.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Ooh la la.
Yeah. It's nice, too.
An industrial-sized box of Smart Start cereal. My favorite.
Oh, really? You like that?
Yeah.
It is good stuff. Nougat. But no, I didn't get you that. No, you will be delighted when you see this.
Really?
You probably don't... equate it or at least think of Costco when you think of this kind of gift.
Wow.
Yeah, I know you think of bulk when you think about Costco. This is not that.
They have everything there.
My interest is peaked.
They got everything, yeah. So you'll be excited to get that. Also, Jimmy and I, we did that thing. Now, I don't know why Jimmy has to go. You know, you go to Costco on a Sunday afternoon and it couldn't get more crowded. The thing that's funny is, you know, Jimmy and I... It almost becomes a competition to see who can buy more useless crap. I have, you know, a box with 275 highlighting pens in it. Jimmy has a box, a slipper dispenser where you pull disposable slippers out, wear them once, and then pull another set out. It's crazy. I mean, just this is why the terrorists hate us. And there was somebody behind us in line, so we pull our wagon train. And it's two oversized shopping carts. They have the industrial size shopping carts, and they're brimming with stuff, and there's stuff shoved in the underneath shelf and everything. And some poor SOB pulls up behind us. He has two dozen eggs, a jar of cashews, and a cat pillow. He has three items in total. Jimmy has, you know, 123 items just in the spice department. That's just the cooking section. Just, you know, 15 different bottles of wine, each one that has to be individually scanned. I have more than he has, and this poor SOB has three items. Now, the thing about the jar of cashews, it's not a 55-gallon drum of cashews. It's a 12-ounce, 14-ounce. You know, it's a little bit bigger than when you would get at the 7-Eleven. He saved himself 89 cents on that item. The cat pillow, that's an unknown. I imagine you could get that almost anywhere. And then the two dozen eggs, well, where else are you going to find that but Costco on a Sunday?
Yeah, that is retarded. Yeah, that didn't register. Of course, you go there to buy in bulk, right?
Oh, you definitely get a savings in eggs, but here's the deal. If you're over 30 and you even know how much eggs are, you should kill yourself. That's the whole thing. You know, people spend a lot of time saying, oh, you know, $2.29, you can get the eggs for over at the Gelson's, but over at Ralph's, it's $1.89. And then if I go to Costco, I can get two dozen for $3.28. Kill yourself is what you should do.
And why are so many people complaining about the gas and everything?
Billy's our 17-year-old.
Wow.
Billy's jumping in on the show.
The question is, why is he jumping in?
Nah, that's a good point. Well, the kid's got moxie.
I know. What, Brusca,
like
right out of the gate, you got to jump on another employee.
I like
another
it.
Mark for Billy, for Brusca to make cry.
Yeah, I wonder if he can make him cry by today. He's got 4 hours.
Billy is our young 17-year-old web I don't know what to call you.
Webmaster.
Assistant webmaster. Yeah. Let me hear you say that. It just sounds good.
Assistant webmaster.
Yeah. That's your title. We got to get some cards made up for you. And he's an assistant webmaster. What school do you go to?
Buena Vista High School.
Buena Vista High School. Which
God
is,
dealt him a good hand. Dealt us a good hand.
Yes.
The,
so
the names and places.
Give me your entire your title. Name, your position here, and your high school.
My name is Billy Moses. I'm the assistant webmaster here for CBS Radio and KLSX and the Adam Carolla Show. And I attend Buena Vista High School in Paramount, California. And there, I'm the ASB president. I'm the school board representative. And I'm also the editor of our school newspaper, the Buena Vista Informer.
Oh, beautiful. It would have been nice if it was called Sentinel, but that's all right.
And also, if you are, what year are you?
Class of 2006.
Are you a freshman or a...
I'm a senior.
Senior. Yeah.
Yeah, instead of in you. Paramount, California, it would be better if he was from Sausalito.
Yeah.
But,
or Studio City.
Yeah. All right, well, nice work, Therese, on that.
Thank you.
So Billy, you're a big fan of mine.
I am definitely a big fan of yours.
I enjoy that, you know. We spoke to your mother the other day when Kimmel was in here. Turns out we couldn't find any pornography on your computer and nothing between the mattress and box spring either.
That is correct.
Smart. Are you porn free?
I am pretty much porn free.
And he told me over the weekend that he has no porn whatsoever.
Yeah. Wow.
Is that normal?
For a 17-year-old? No.
He's a 21st century pornographer, believe me. It's not that hard to do the math. He's an assistant webmaster, after all. He knows how to tap into what the online has to offer.
So you're saying he was lying to Bresca?
I just know how to clear history and everything on the computer.
He doesn't own porn. He just makes it.
Yeah. Right.
Exactly.
So, all right. So you're working on our stuff. We found out you didn't have a prom date. The prom is coming up when?
It is in May 20th, I believe.
May 20th.
Somewhere around there, give or take a day.
Right. Three weeks away or so plus, and you need a date, right?
Yes, sir.
All right. Do you have someone you're interested in?
I do.
You do?
Yes.
Does she know who you are?
Yes, she does. It's actually my older sister's friend.
Ooh, older sister's friend.
Yes.
Now, is she older as well?
Yes, she is.
How much?
I think she's 20.
20?
Ooh.
So she's not in high school anymore?
No, she's not.
That's a big leap, 17 to 20. Yeah?
Yes, it is, but I mean...
So what's she doing with her life?
I'm sorry?
What is she doing?
I don't know. I think she's attending college right now. I'm not sure.
Junior college?
Yeah.
All right. She's
attainable. Enough said.
Yeah, you can get her. Bamboozle her with something. All right, so... Are we going to talk to her, Bresca? Are we going to give her a call at some point?
I don't think right now would probably not be a good idea. Why? Get her while she's not lucid.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. The element of surprise.
Well, if she goes to junior college, she's still up and really high right now because they insist that all their students do drugs into the wee hours. I mean,
we can call her now if you want, or after the break or whatever.
It's up to you, sir.
Why is she confident, man? All right. Well, hold on. I mean, she's not gonna be awake, is she?
I think we should call later.
Yeah.
All right.
8:39 or something.
All right, we'll keep everyone posted. Billy, excuse yourself.
Okay.
Thank you.
No problem. Thank you.
Now, what's that like, though, by the way? So you and Kim will go to the store. You have to go with him because why? Because he's the king of Costco. He knows the ins and outs, all the nooks and crannies.
Yeah.
Because he's there three times a week, roughly.
He's what Robert Urich was to Vegas in the late 70s. He comes in, a lot of hot chicks pushing carts, turning their heads and sliding their sunglasses down and saying, isn't that Jimmy Tana? And he's high-fiving the guard, and right this way, Mr. Kimmel. You know, they removed the velvet rope and let us into the electronics section. No problem. No questions asked.
No one eats the samples of sliced sausage with more suave and debonair than Kimmel.
Yeah, that's right. That's how it works. The lines part. Kimmel steps up front, takes a toothpick full of mini Vienna sausage, and then makes his way right back to the dairy aisle.
Women swoon.
Oh, it's huge.
Well, you think he, you know, as the mayor of Costco, he might have given cuts to that guy with only three items.
He didn't notice that guy because that guy was behind me, and I didn't notice him either because that's not the way I live my life, children. I don't spend life staring in the rear view. I'm looking down the highway ahead. But I did turn around after I'd offloaded, you know, it took me 25 minutes just to get all my items onto the conveyor belt. When I looked back, I saw the pathetic family with the three items, and like I said, total savings. Well, the eggs are a weird one because, again, that's ubiquitous. I mean, just go to a cheap supermarket and go buy eggs. I imagine they're marginally cheaper. But, you know, if you go to Costco and you get yourself a large ticket item, you will definitely save some money. Or you're buying 700 eggs, then it's worth it. But for literally two dozen eggs, it's probably about 20 or 30 cents. This idea that people... I tell you this firsthand because my family is poor. They're all poor. And they've all got... their plan has worked out, by the way. Their financial plan has worked out such that I'm leasing everyone an automobile at this late stage in their life. I mean, nobody's figured anything out. Everyone comes to me for money. They're not on the streets. They're not destitute. But they're, whatever financial plans they made did not work out, clearly. Which is always funny when they give me sound financial advice. You know, I say, yeah, I'm thinking about renting out the one house. I don't think I'm going to sell it. I think I'm going to rent it out and keep it when I move into the new house. And then the Corollas pipe up. And then it's like, son, you sure? Because you get somebody in there. Then mom pipes up. Yeah, you rent to somebody. Hold on. Hold on a second, the Rockefellers. You, I've been leasing a car for 8 years. So I'm not... not going to listen to you, and you live at the crappy house your mom lets you squat. Do not technically own a house. That's covered you too. Any more financial advice? Maybe you guys should do one of those weekend radio shows where you give out financial advice. We'll have an ISDN line put in the crappy house that you get to live in. How about that? Jesus Christ. You know when people, here's the whole thing about opinions. Like, it's just like guys with horrible physique should not be offering workout tips. First off, take a good look in the mirror before you dispense any advice. Learn to speak another language before you start giving people tips on the cultures that you're talking about. You know what I'm talking about? People, maybe in this society, maybe even more than any society, seem obliged to dispense advice, pearls of wisdom, their opinions. And when you take a good look at the person, it's like, holy F, this person's got no, this person should be ashamed to speak on this topic. Actually, yes. We have that problem with actors talking about politics. We have that problem with poor people talking about how to get rich and what it's going to take to get ahead. As a matter of fact, the less money you have, the more theories you have on what it's going to take to get ahead. Actually, people that are rich rarely talk about what it's going to take. They just go out and do it every day. And the poor people have 1,001 things about how the people have the money, make the rules and what it takes and all that kind of stuff. It's almost in lieu of doing it. Here's what I'm saying. Everybody, stop trying to save money and start trying to make money. That's the mode you should be in. Not the, I have to pinch every penny. Not the, I'm going to get on the local news because the 76 station raised their gas prices 3 cents, and I'm going to write a letter to the mayor. No, no, no. How are you going to make 6 cents to offset the 3 cents? Not complain about the 3 cents. That's what we do. We waste too much time complaining and think about your job is to make so much money you don't even know when that stuff happens.
Well, listen, our whole society, this is the old cliche, those who can do, those who can't teach. And I figured it out at a very early age. And that's why I had such a poor relationship throughout my schooling with my teachers.
You figured out that these guys right. were losers early on.
By about age 7 or 8, I figured I'm smarter than this J.O.
And they didn't deserve your respect.
Yeah, and they didn't like that.
I agree. Justin?
Yeah?
Your wife hates porn?
Oh, yeah. And she keeps on catching me.
Yeah.
On the history. It's a bummer. So I wanted to ask the kid, how do I get that taken care of?
Yeah, I've been popped a few times in the history department, too.
I hate that.
Yeah.
Why don't you, pay attention to me? I'm like, well, it's a little bit better than you.
Women do not understand that if you have a magical box in your house for which all porn will stream, that's way too tall an order to ask a guy not to look into that box. Justin?
Yeah.
How old are you?
I'm 22, my friend.
22, especially 22-year-old Billy. Can you help him erase his history?
I definitely can.
Yeah.
All you need to do is go to Tools, and under the Internet Options, you go to Cookies, and you delete Cookies.
Cookies?
Cookies. Yes. That's awesome, my friend.
Cookies, that's a PC thing, right?
Yes, it is.
All right, how about you just do what I do? You just dump a beer on it.
Or you could do that.
I mean, you make it seem like an accident, and of course the thing is ruined, but if you have the kind of money that I have, you send Kimmel out to Costco to pick up another computer.
It's disposable.
It's disposable, and you save some face, which you can't put a price on. All right, Justin, go to go where, and then Tools, and then Cookies?
Tools, Internet Options. Click on Internet Options, and you'll see like a whole bunch of options. And it's about halfway down. It says Delete Cookies. You just press that, and everything's gone.
Okay, Billy may have inadvertently came up with names for the twins, Tool and Cookie.
I like it.
Tool and Cookie Corolla.
Excellent.
Solid. And that way, I'll never forget how to erase the porn.
Yep.
Exactly.
A constant reminder.
Go ahead and make, at least if you're going to do Tool, make it Power Tool.
Oh, that's good. Powers Tool.
Yeah.
Good one. Yeah, you know, I think I should name, you know how you do stuff like, well, you'll do your pin on your bank thing, your birth date, so you don't forget it. I mean, it'd be nice, instead of just naming your kids randomly, give them something that helps you remember a code or pin number. You know, like I said, well, I don't mean, you know, you shouldn't give your kid a ridiculous name. But for instance, if one was named Tool and the other one's named Cookie, I might be at the computer one day, see the wife pull up the driveway in the Volvo, think, holy Christ, how do I raise this? And then think back, look up, see a picture of the kids. That's right. Tool and Cookie. Done. Thank you. Thank you. That's what it sounds like. Now, it actually sounds like tick. Tick, tick. Yeah, sort of like that. Whatever.
Does your wife actually get angry about the porn?
No, she's learned to accept it. I've also gotten a note from a doctor. It's considered medical porn.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, you know, there's medical marijuana. Sure. There's certain things that people can do that society sort of looks down their nose at. But there's a handful. It says no, it's okay. This is medicinal. I need this. I have a note from Dr. Bruce. You thought I was going to say Dr. Drew, but I couldn't get him to do it. But there is a guy who's a quack named Dr. Bruce gave me a note. It's medical porn.
That's the guy giving Courtney Love all the Vicodin she wants.
I can write it off. I can get it. I can go down to places in San Francisco and get it, unless the feds close them down. Medical porn. I like that idea. Great. You know, and I have no problem. I can, there's special parking places for me. The medical porn. I'll show you the sign. It's great. It's a pot leaf with that cane and the snake going up it. Medical porn. All right, let's take ourselves a break. We have a comedian. Boy, I'm really in love with that medical porn idea. I'm just going to figure out what to do with it. Yeah. Mike Birbiglia is coming in here. We'll be right back after this.
Know the difference between campus police and police. Police carry guns. Campus police carry flashlights and sometimes water bottles.
Oh, sorry. I was enjoying that. It'd be nice. Why do we just hear, you know, why do we have to hear 35 seconds? How about, you know, we hear the whole CD or two of them?
Yeah, keep the bar light, nice and low for us.
Well, if you look at it this way, we're not going to do any better than a professional comedy CD. No. And if you really think about it, why would we? Yeah. You know what I mean? I mean, maybe if we'd really planned out the show and then edited it and distilled it down to the funniest moments and all that, but why not just play other
Water
people's funny?
Under the bridge now. Let's go get some eggs and we'll talk about it while we play Mike Birbiglia's CD.
Mike Birbiglia is in the studio. Two Drink Mike's the name of the CD.
Thanks. That wasn't even from the CD. That was a really obscure audio clip that I have not heard it on the internet or anything, actually.
Really?
That was from it was something on Comedy Central.
Well, speaking of Comedy Central, are you, you've been out doing the tour, the college tour with them, right?
It's called the Medium Man on Campus Tour.
And it's got to be nice. I mean, if you're going to go do comedy for people, that's the place to go, isn't it?
Yeah. It's good. I mean, it's good because the kids, you know, they know younger references and they tend to be hipper to more things. But then also the shows are produced by kids, so it's just luck of the draw terms of what the show's gonna be like. You know?
But there's a lot of hot chicks. Are there hot chicks? They're at least college
age
chicks.
I mean,
you're a celebrity to them.
I don't know. I don't even know if that's true. It's all dorks who go to comedy shows. You know that.
Yeah.
It's all nerds. It's all it's all like, you know.
Yeah, I know. We used to do college shows. We'd do Loveline. We'd go around and do colleges. Well, there would be some hotties depending on which college you went to. And yes, it's probably different if you're on MTV as opposed to, you know, at the Deli Smoker doing stand-up. But when you travel around, boy, you do realize the difference between DeKalb in northern Illinois and somewhere in Florida. Dr. Drew used to always, as we gazed out amongst the faces, would turn to me if we were in a good place and say, a lot of talent in the audience.
Nice to know, clinician.
Even a man of Dr. Drew's status still is a man of passion.
That's fascinating.
Yeah, a lot of talent. Yeah. Oh boy, you go to Florida State and look out in the audience. You go to Arizona State, you look out in the audience, or you head out to DeKalb, Illinois.
Although the one surprising one this week is Utah. It has so much talent.
Oh really?
Oh yeah, the Mormons are gorgeous,
good looking people.
Oh,
huh?
Yeah.
Wow. And
gorgeous. Steve Young is handsome.
He's a good looking man. You have to think about Mormons and football for every year. I mean, Steve Young's all you could come up with.
Napoleon Dynamite.
Is there any hot Mormon chicks?
On Big Love, but those aren't really Mormons.
Anyway, Mike, where were we? I wanted to ask you about your blog,
by the way. This is my secret public journal is something I write.
How do you find that? I don't know enough about computers to even know how you find a blog.
I don't really know either.
Blog, what do I do?
Well, it's mysecretpublicjournal.com.
Mm-hmm.
But initially, that's because I originally wrote it on my own website. And then I asked some people who know about that kind of stuff, like, could we have its own blog? Mm-hmm. Like, could it have that too? And so that's how, I mean, I don't know anything about that guy.
What might we find on this?
This is actually an entry. I've been on tour for about a month now. I'm on a tour bus. And this is sort of how I came to it. This is a journal entry I wrote last month. Dear Secret Journal, I've just completed the first leg of my Medium Man on Campus tour. And I'm very relieved that I made it to my first 7 shows because my dirty little secret is that when I wake up in the morning to catch the flight, there's a tiny little man in my head who I call Sleepy Carl, who insists that, in fact, we don't have to go to fly to Charlottesville, Virginia, but rather that we could be better served by lying in bed for another 4 hours and fading in and out of consciousness.
I have one of them, too.
Yeah.
Yeah,
this is not a new phenomenon. When I was in college, I took a class called Computers and Networks, and it was at 9 in the morning. And I went to the first class and found that a lot of stuff was way over my head. Like, the professor was talking about computers. So the next morning, when I woke up for class, Sleepy Carl was like, why would you go listen to someone talk gibberish about computers when you could stay here and ride on a Ferris wheel made of pizza? And I was like, good point, Carl.
Yeah.
And I stopped going to class. I never went to class again. I went to the class before the final, thinking that I would find out what's on the final, take a stab at it.
Mm-hmm.
The guy sitting next to me says to me, do you think we'll get back the final? And I said, we took the final? Oh, no. And I ran across the hall of the computer science department. And I walked in and I said, hi, I'd like to speak with Professor, but I didn't know his name because I hadn't been going to class. And the professor teaches across the hall in like 5 minutes from now, and the guy said, that's me. And I said, hello, I'm Mike Birbiglia, and I'm in your class, and I misunderstood the syllabus, and I missed the final. And he was so angry, he didn't even look at me, he just looked at the floor, and he said, you get the worst grade. And the worst part was I didn't know what that meant. I was like, so I get a zero? And he goes, you get the grade that the person who did the worst in the test passed the test. Got on the test, right? So it turns out the person who did the worst on the test passed the test.
Wow. Uh-huh.
So I passed the test.
Good deal for you.
And I passed the class. And I'm proud to be an American.
See, Carl was right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I decided to get a bus.
Mm-hmm.
Because that way I couldn't sleep through flights. Because right. I've slept through flights before. I mean, I've been the guy sprinting it to the airport and like banging on the glass.
Yes.
That guy.
Yes. I've been that guy too. And I'll tell you what I figured out though, because I'm almost late to every flight. And I've gotten to this philosophical argument with people. Jimmy Kimmel, who I've flown with a ton, loves to get to the airport 4 or 5 hours early and sit around. I love to get there at the last second. The thing about it is, if you really think about it, first off, if you do miss a flight, and I've missed a handful of flights in my career, you'll usually get on another flight or somehow work it out so that the delay translates into about an hour or an hour and a half. It's usually not a day. It's not 7 hours. Usually figure it out. If you think about the handful of flights you've missed in your short life, you figured out some way to do something to get on a plane somewhere an average of about an hour and change afterwards. So that's your time. That hour and change, that's what you have to make up. Now, sometimes you had a car to pick you up. Sometimes you had something to do when you land. But most of the time, you show up an hour later to wherever you were going, and you're back on track again. You just get to the hotel an hour later, whatever it is. So if you go to the airport and you insist on getting there an hour, 2 hours early, and on the flight back, it's an hour, 2 hours early, too, by the time you've done 4 or 5 flights, you've now logged about 10 hours of sitting around in an airport, enough to fly to Europe. Believe me, Kimmel, because he likes to get to the airport early, 5 or 6 flights, he'll log enough airport time to fly to Australia. Whereas I show up only moments before the plane leaves. Thus, his flight to New York is 8 hours, and my flight to New York is 6 hours and 8 minutes. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, I follow.
Doing
that.
It that way. Time is time. Yeah. That's all. You're on the planet for a certain amount of it. Your job is to abuse it.
But I can't handle that. You show up late, and then you have to convince the person at the front desk that they can have to put you on the flight. You have to be in that that powerless situation where you're like, maybe you can go.
Yeah, you don't understand. I do that. Comedy for stoners.
Oh, Christ. I should kill myself.
There's a show I'm on.
One of my greatest moments was flying to Florida with Dr. Drew, and he made the flight, and I didn't, and he was on the flight, and the flight was just parked there, and I was telling him to let me on the plane, and they wouldn't let me on the plane, and we were supposed to go in Florida, and there's going to be like 6,000, 8,000 people at the gig, and Drew eventually got off the plane, and then we had a monumental argument because he left his overcoat on the plane that his wife just got him. But I started yelling at the guy. This is one of the more surreal moments in my life, where I started yelling at the guy, find me the helpful guy from the commercial. And I was at my wit's end at this point, and he didn't know what I was talking about, but gibberish was just coming out of my mouth at this point, where I was yelling, you know, the super helpful guy, you know, in the commercial, because I've seen the American Airline commercials, you know, that guy, you know, when the guy leaves his attaché case and he sprints across the airport and yells, Dr. Johnson, you've left your briefcase, that guy, go find him. Go get him. I want to talk to him because we're not getting anywhere. The plane is sitting there. We're both looking at it. We're both off the plane. Everything's hooked up. We have 2 first class tickets. We need to get on this plane now, but not. And then argued for half an hour while the plane just sat there. No such luck.
The people I feel bad for flying these days, obviously, are Middle Eastern people. Because like my Middle Eastern friends, like, you know, everyone sitting around them on the plane has a plan.
Sure.
Like, my friend's just heading to, like, the Referees of America conference in St. Louis. Guy next to him is thinking, this son of a bitch lifts a finger. I'm going to bash him in the head with my laptop. Then I'm going to smother him with my travel pillow. That's my plan. By the way, that's my plan.
It was,
Don't use it.
Keep going back to Kimmel, but we did, he had a plan, too. We flew to New York to do the Hugh Hefner roast 2 weeks after 9/11, and everybody was agitated. I mean, everyone was freaked out. You look back at it, you don't really remember how freaky it was to fly in the few weeks and months after 9/11. We're sitting up front in first class, and Jimmy said he announced on the way to the airport 4 hours early, he'll not be able to close his eyes. He'll not be able to sleep a wink on this plane. He's going to be keeping a constant vigil. He was snoring audibly before we took off. That was his plan. Maybe he wanted to lull the terrorists into a false sense of security.
Sleepy Carl had another plan.
That's right. Sleepy Carl intervened. It was like head tilted back, saliva coming down onto the T-shirt, and didn't even make the takeoff. All right, Sleepy Carl. I like him.
Sleepy Carl is like a bad employee. He's like the guy who takes over for the night shift. You know, he's got like, he's always like slobbering in your pillow and muttering about Vietnam. And sometimes he'll get out of bed and turn off your alarm, knowing you have to wake up at a certain time in the morning.
He can be a jerk. It is amazing how that guy, Sleepy Carl, the evil Sleepy Carl, will lose his grip over the years, but it's nothing, no tighter grip than when you're in high school or you're in college. You know, that is a, I don't know if women have this, but guys, 17, 18, 19, that thing where you have to get up and go to work or go to class or whatever.
It's like some people get out of bed like they're getting off the bench at a basketball game. They're like, all right, let's do this.
I don't like those people. Yes. You know the a-holes who talk about working out, like the a-holes who hit the gym before? These people are so obnoxious.
People who miss it. I'm not happy. Why? I haven't worked out in 2 days.
Yeah, that guy I don't like. I don't like the guy who claims about how invigorating it is to work out before you go to work. I don't like the people who make announcements of what they do before they go to work. They feel like braggarts to me. Like there's people like, the worst is the swimmers. I'll do about a mile. I'll go down the Y, do about a couple hours. Get out of. First off, they do that thing. It's like, boy, when you get out of that pool, you've been submerged in 60 degree water for the last 2 hours. I'd say you're awake. Yeah. There's no chance of you dozing off in the deep end of the pool. Yeah, you know, swimming is the worst.
Yeah.
I swim every morning.
And they got the best bodies.
Yeah,
swimmers.
It's the best exercise, the best. I'll go ahead and do about 75 laps at the Y before I head to the gym, before I go to the range, before I go by the children's hospital, and then I go to work.
20 minutes of prayer and then work.
Oh, the people that meditate, the people that do the yoga. They'll do anything except for eat. Those are the people, and even the people that eat, if they eat health food, I'm angry at them. I like the guy who says, I wake up and I hawk the world's biggest loogie. I go ahead and beat myself silly. Then I cook up some ham and I dump some eggs on that and a couple cups of coffee, put a little Bailey's in the coffee, and it's off, drag my ass to work.
To wake up to get here, it's like, I call the hotel. Could I have a wake-up call for 5:30, 5:40, 5:55, and 1:30 p.m.?
There should be a... Here's a good idea, Mike. Put this in the book. Wake-up call snooze bar. Somehow, we mix it with the mini bar. I don't know how we do it, but they call at 5:30, and you're able to pick the phone up and hang it up, and they'll call. That'll mean you slap the phone.
I've actually paid people to come to my room to wake me up.
Wow.
Because I'm so worried.
I like the people that know there's a devil inside of them and they have to beat it. Like, well, what I do, first off, I have an alarm clock that starts a fire. That's the only, it bursts into flames, and I'll go ahead and I'll put the curtains right on it before I go to bed. That's the only way. Another guy says you have to hide alarm clocks, and I'll go, well, you got one on the nightstand because you got the other across the room. That's right. I have to get up and go walk over there, and in between, I put a moat. And that wakes me up. Like the people, like, you understand, you are just talking about you. You're not trying to fool some evil twin, right?
Yeah. Sleepy Carl talking.
I used to put thumbtacks on my alarm in college.
Really?
Yeah. So you wouldn't. On the snooze button so I wouldn't just hit it.
How about
eventually I figured out that there was like a quarter inch at the end of it that I could hit on the side and still hit the snooze without stabbing myself.
It is a crate. Yes, you hot glued broken glass to your own alarm clock. But it is a weird, it's a weird thing as human beings that we have to, like the folks that like to set their clock up 8 or 10 minutes. I'm going to fool myself. I'm going to trick myself. I'm going to somehow force myself. How about you just do it? It's a weird thing where there's sort of two of you inside of you. One smart, one evil. One's trying to trick the other into doing the right thing.
I've thought about this a lot, and I think the reason that I have a hard time waking up is because my dreams are better than my life. Mm-hmm. Like, my dreams are so effortless. It's kind of like a movie. Like, I want to go to the store. Cut to the store.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Fade to black. Fade to black. Pizza montage. And then I wake up, and I'm like, I want to go to the store, but I'm still in my bed, and I don't have a car with pepperoni wheels. This day is going terribly, you know?
Mike Birbiglia is here. We'll take a break. Frank Vincent is... Coleman from Sopranos, also Vincent Pastore from The Sopranos will be in. Ace Young, Ozzy's got a movie review, but more with Mike after this.
It's funny with drinking, there's really sports analogies when you drink, pre-game, party foul. I have to make up my own. The other day I was like, oh, I pulled a hamstring. My friend was like, what does that mean? I was like, I threw up on your couch. And then I did it again, I was like, 30 love. 30 love.
Mike Birbiglia in studio. To Drink Mike, name of the CD. Out as we speak.
Yeah, I'm hoping that people either purchase it or steal it off the internet. I'm fine with both.
Either way.
What a sport.
Doesn't matter.
You want to get your voice out there. You're an artist.
And you ultimately want to own a pizzeria.
That's right. Your dream. That was my goal when I was a kid. I wanted to be a comedian. Or a rapper, or the owner of a pizza restaurant where third graders could hang out.
This is an interesting question then, because Carol and I have argued this in depth. What do you think is the best pizza topping?
Interesting.
I actually think that the bear cheese pizza is probably it's the control experiment for all pizzas.
It's a good point, yeah.
When you go somewhere, I think you should always just get the cheese just to know what you're dealing with.
Yeah.
The toppings are interchangeable in a certain way.
Don't marry a woman until you see her without her makeup.
Yeah.
Yeah, let's strip it down and see what we got here. Then we can build after that. Yeah. Yeah, I know. We had a bunch of pizza delivered. Listen, everybody, please, thin crust. That's the direction to go with pizza. The super doughy, chewy, crappy stuff is not the way to go. And listen, you retards, don't bring up your one example of Geno's East.
About Chicago, I know.
Here's the thing. Everybody has a crazy example of, you say thin crust. Oh, no, there's this one place. Yes, that's not what's before us. The stuff we got came from a place that had the word hut on the end of it, and therefore it sucks. Thank you.
I was talking to this pizza authority guy. I forgot his name, but he wrote a whole book on pizza, and the one thing he pointed out was it's a myth Chicago has... that Chicago has good pizza. They just don't.
Look, the best, pizza.
I apologize, but it's bad.
Thin, wide, fold it, taco it in half. And it's always nice when you can use another food as an example of what to do with your food.
Right.
Taco the pizza and then slide it in sideways. And I'm not talking about your mouth. Oh, no.
I think the only problem with pizza is that pizza's always hanging out with salad. Salad's like pizza's friendly but annoying friend.
Yes.
Salad's fine sometimes, but once in a while, I gotta be like, look, salad, me and pizza want to be alone.
Yes, it's pizza's fat friend.
And the pizzeria, you'll name the pizzeria, hopefully, Sleepy Carl's.
Sleepy Carl's,
Sleepy Carl's, no salad pizzeria.
I also say that pepperoni overdone. Pepperoni is the catch-all topping. Dave disagrees with
me.
Here's what I say. When you're a kid and you're ordering pizza for the kids' party, you go, give me 5 cheese and 5 pepperoni. You know you're covered. That carries over into the adult life. And I say, no, not 5 pepperoni. Get some meatball. Get some sausage and onion. Get some mushroom. Spread it around a little.
Yeah. I named sliced meatball the topping of the year last year, as you know. However... pepperoni is, like, vanilla ice cream is not everybody's favorite, but it's a fine default. Pepperoni is number one for a reason, because it's very tasty.
I love that you treated your own ranking with authority.
Yeah.
You're just like, I named it.
Yes.
Best topping of the year last year. Oh, all right.
I think that's upset, Dave.
Spicy meatballs.
I didn't come here to be attacked by you.
Oh, no.
Teresa.
Yes.
Affectionate.
You were going to do some Hollywood happenings,
yes.
I do believe.
As soon as I hear some music, I'll be there.
Nice.
Can't do the happenings without the lounge music. It's a happy song for a little bit of an unhappy story. You might remember that Denise Richards filed for divorce from Charlie Sheen. Then they tried to reconcile. Now she's reinstating it. A 17-page declaration filed Friday in Los Angeles. Court explains why she is reinstating her divorce. And the allegations about her estranged husband, Charlie Sheen, are very, very ugly. They include, she accuses her husband of visiting pornography websites featuring underage-looking girls and underage-looking boys, of emailing photos of his erect penis to prospective partners, and of being addicted to sports gambling. And if that's not enough, she also accuses him of threatening her and her family. Sheen, of course, denying the allegations.
It's tough when the allegations are very specific.
Yeah.
You know, like if he said, hey, this guy was just a chick hound or a jerk, you're fine. But if you said, like, I walked into the den about 4 a.m. on a Tuesday morning because a car backfire woke me up and found him wearing my bear claw slippers on one foot and making love to the other one while he played, an opera was coming over the, you go, oh, wow. Yeah, no, he did that. The whole penis thing, I believe.
Yeah, it's one of those instances, like, a lot of times when I'm driving in the middle of nowhere, there'll be these signs for porn. Like, pull over, we have porn. Mm-hmm. And then there'll be Christian ones next to them that are like, porn destroys lives.
Yeah.
And for a split second, you'll think that that's like a specific type of porn. Do you guys have that porn that destroys lives?
Yeah.
But that's like an instance of like, that might destroy lives. Like, that description.
Well, I'd say maybe he's addicted to sex.
It would seem that way. There's definitely been a long history of him with the prostitutes and the
I would work that angle if I was him at this point, because that's now a legitimate medical condition. You know, when I was a kid, if you're addicted to sex, he'd laugh you right out of the courtroom. Now, it's an actual viable. Yes.
Do you think you could get
medical porn? Right. Yes. If you that's what you do. You go into your doctor, you convince them that you're addicted to sex, and then you get a prescription or subscription, whichever you like, for medical porn.
Yeah.
And by the way, once you get medical porn, you can go to crowded parks and gymborees and, you know, Chuck E. Cheese and just open your porn willy-nilly. Like, if I brought my nephews to Chuck E. Cheese and I brought Milkin' and Poppin' in there, I would just sit back with impunity and read my porn. Hey, this is medical porn. How dare you try to take it away? Interesting. Yeah. Well, on airplanes, public places, libraries, churches, synagogues. Yeah, it's medical porn.
And if indeed it's true that he, and it obviously it's an allegation and he's denied it, but if it is indeed true that he sent his erect penis around on the internet, that is not unusual. I have a friend. She was on J-Date. She was just talking with a guy back and forth on email. She said, can you send me a picture, make me blush? And he sent one, and it was like his unzipped thing and with his penis.
Wow. Wow. You know what I would do if I was on J-Day besides...
Kill yourself?
Try to convince people I was Jewish. No, and besides kill myself, I would get... If I did any kind of internet cruising and whatevering, I would find a picture of a huge penis, but not a professional picture of a huge penis. One that looked like it had been laid down on a Xerox copy or something. Something crude. If you sent that around, that 11-inch around, it would seem very believable.
Oh, yeah, because women find that completely charming.
Oh, yeah, it's a turn-on. I've seen enough porn to know.
Speaking of things that women find charming, Tom Cruise on 2020 Friday discussing his feelings about the birth of his new baby girl.
Tell you what, it was everything that we wanted. And, you know, you hear about it and you experience it, and it was spiritual. It was powerful. It was indescribable. What words... can you use?
I don't know. He's talking about having sex,
or something that I'm processing,
the woman?
And I keep reliving. All of us do that moment over and over again.
You know, this is so sad because my wife is very pregnant with twins, and every time one of these blowhards comes in there, they ruin it for guys like me that are sort of lukewarm on the kits. You know what I mean?
You've got to be that happy now.
Yeah, we all have to use Tom Cruise. This is what women do. They watch this guy talking about how profoundly in love he is, jumping up on sofas, talking about how thrilled he is. And then my wife turns to me and says, You don't seem nearly as excited, and we're having twins. Oh, listen, I'm not. I got no problem. You know, I defend myself in a retarded way. I don't have any beef with them, if that's what you're asking.
Are these your first kids?
Yes.
Wow.
Yeah. And I got to hear the Tom Cruises of the world explain how elated they are over the birth of their children. Then I just look like a stump. I was going to use the F word.
I can't wait to see how Pat O'Brien and company cover the birth of the Corolla twins. It's going to be all week long, wall to wall on the Insider.
Cookie and Tool.
Little Cookie and Tool. Well, actually, there's more news on the baby, the Tom Kitten's name, Suri. Apparently, according to one linguistics guy over at the Hebrew University, it means something akin to get out of here. So you should be careful when you're choosing names, as I know you are, that the names don't have other meanings of which you're not aware.
Interesting. Yeah. Cookie could mean something other than delightful, sweet confection. Yes. All right.
Okay. And then lastly, box office this weekend, Silent Hill knocks off Scary Movie 4, raking in over $20 million. American Dreams, I had high hopes for
I'm sorry for jumping in, but I realized if I'm making a movie, I'm making a horror movie now because it's so easy to get idiots to go. Yeah. And then I realized all you have to do a horror movie is have that shot where the chick is in the bathroom and she's washing her face in the sink and then puts her head up and closes the mirror on the medicine cabinet, and there's an 8-year-old cute girl who's dressed as a schoolgirl who goes, "I want your soul," in the mirror, and then they cut to the thing and you're in, right?
Right.
So all you gotta do is have the little schoolgirly talk with the huge man's voice and we'll have her appear via the mirror when we close the medicine cabinet.
Be fun, though. It'd be a nice twist, though, if there were a horror movie instead of the very deep baritone kind of voice, scary thing in Congress with a little girl, if instead it were your voice, Corolla. Like,
absolutely. That would be scary. That's the thing. It's horror movies aren't specific enough.
Yeah, they should be recognizable.
The thing closes, and all of a sudden, it's just, the little girl's voice all of a sudden just starts going like, "Here's the deal with doughy pizza. Enough with the pepperoni already. Am I right? Can we get some mushroom? onion in there?
How about a huge menacing devil creature that had the voice of Dakota Fanning? Flip it around.
Interesting.
Who would you be more scared of?
Yeah, speaking of voices, I saw you. I loved your thing. I saw you on Kimmel the other night, and Mike, and you were talking about that every black comedian does their impression of what a white guy sounds like.
Yeah,
Sharis.
That's right. The white guy voice. A lot of black comics have the one white guy voice. Like, this is ridiculous.
Yes, I think Richard Pryor started that, and they all do. Yeah. They all do Richard Pryor. Yes. They don't do white guys.
Yeah, it's like we all talk like British detectives. You know, and
scared British, scared.
Yeah, with long jaw.
And I don't know anyone who talks like that, but I feel bad for the one guy on Earth who does talk like that, and he's watching those comics on TV, and he's like, "This is preposterous. That doesn't sound like me at all. Wait till I get my hands on that black fellow. But first, I'm going to dance." White people are terrible dancers.
Yeah, I know. It's tough.
But I was going to read
the Star Jones book.
I have the Star Jones book. I was reading it this morning. And
little Carl tell you to read it, or Sleepy and, Carl. Little Carl's your penis, I forgot. Sleepy
and,
Carl.
Yeah. This is a passage about how she met Al. And I thought I would read this in the white guy voice.
Great.
"I was charmed out of my wits. I stopped, looked into those chocolate eyes, and I literally heard a bell ring.
Literally.
Just like my mother said it would. When I walked into that room the day I met Al Scales Reynolds."
Literally.
"Al Scales Reynolds.
Scales.
I didn't walk in with the intention of meeting someone. I walked in with my mind on feeling good about me. I was prepared, and I'd started on getting ready, and my relationship with God was strong, and my health was getting better day by day, and my weight loss program had been moving along for months, and when that tall, smart, wonderful man took my arm, I was emotionally, physically, and spiritually ready to accept him. I deserved him. And you know what? I wasn't looking for him. He was looking for me."
Well, how's he going to miss her?
More soulful than star.
By the way, is there anyone who will admit when they look back on a relationship that they're actually heading out to score? You know what I mean? It's always, look, yeah, exactly. I was in no place. Yeah. I didn't even want anything. And I remember when he first approached, how about you just admit one day you hadn't had a good bang in at least 4 years and we're out on the prowl looking for some sweet, sweet peanut.
Yeah, yeah.
How about that?
How many of those stories start off as, you would not believe the girl I banged last night.
Right.
And then like months later are, oh, it's actually getting really serious.
I'm freaked out. Yeah. Little Carl, I mean,
Sleepy Carl.
Sleepy Carl keeps telling me to kill her and then flee to Mexico.
I lived with a girl for a while in New York, and we worried about different things. One day I said, what do you fear the most? And she said, I fear you'll meet someone else and you'll leave me and I'll be all alone. And she said, what do you fear most? And I said, bears. But it's a legitimate fear.
We need to take ourselves a little break. Frank Vincent is calling in. Vincent Pastore. I think we're going to have him in at the same time. Yes, one on the phone, one on the stool. So some Sopranos talk as well as other conversations. I want to thank Mike Birbiglia for coming in there. Birbiglia for coming in. The name of the CD. Well, where is that?
Two Drink Mike.
I got it. Yes, Two Drink Mike. Out now. Thanks, Mike. Come back anytime.
Thanks a lot.
We'll be right back after this.
Smarten up. You're listening to the Adam Carolla Show.
Mm-hmm. Vincent Pastore, Big Pussy, in studio. Oh. Mike fell. There we go. Frank Vincent, Filiotardo, is going to call in as he always does. So before we get into the Sopranos, which actually everyone saw last night except for Vincent, ironically, is...
I was too busy doing physical exercise here in Los Angeles.
You you got laid, huh?
Yeah.
Nice.
No, that's not what happened. I'm doing
Celebrity Fit Club. When you started taping that?
Yeah, we started... I did some B-Unit back in New York, and now I'm in the whole... the routine, you know, where they weigh your ass up and they tell you to go run around the track and do push-ups and jumping jacks. You know, I'm just making a jerk out of myself.
How much have you lost thus far?
Adam, I just started the show.
Just started? You haven't lost an ounce yet?
No.
Started. You know, What's your goal?
What is my goal?
You don't look very heavy to me.
No, I put on, what happened is I quit smoking. I had surgery, I quit smoking, and I put on about 30 pounds. I want to get rid of that. So my goal is to get back to what I was weighing before, to get back, I want to lose about 30 pounds.
Well, don't lose too much, or people are going to start talking about you like you're the next Vito Spadafora.
No.
Lost the weight, and we know what happened to him.
There's no way in the world you're going to compare me to that character.
Would you have played him if they'd handed you that script?
No, Adam, I would have gave the role to you.
Hey, I would have done it. You got hit. Was it the beginning of the second season?
Second year. End of the
second year. Yeah. That's got to be, somebody handed me something that said they went and checked some IMDb stuff that said you may be doing a little more filming this year. Some flashback stuff, perhaps?
I don't know about it. What, somebody told you that?
Yeah.
No.
Well, the word's out that you're doing filming for Sopranos.
Well, I don't know. I know the word's out, but, maybe it's going to happen. Maybe I'm going to look for Frankie Valli's body now, right?
Yeah.
So Frankie got, I didn't see it last night, but I knew it was coming. Frankie got whacked last night?
Yes.
Sitting in his car riding shotgun.
That's a shame. Yeah. He's got a big hit out, Jersey Boys and everything. He can't enjoy all the benefits. A
couple guys now from the old country flew in just to carry out the hit.
Oh, yes. Boy. I'll watch it. Okay, so we got it. Frank Vincent's going to call him. We'll talk about that.
Have you been watching religiously?
Yes, I have been watching. I a couple of episodes I got disappointed, and some of them I thought were just flawless. So it's
which ones disappointed you?
The second one when he was in the coma and he became somebody else. And he was about to go into the house, and the house was with all the dead people. It was just a little too weird for me.
Too big a departure. Too far out.
I didn't understand why he was somebody else. Did you figure that one out?
No, but I just figure it's because I'm stupid.
No, I don't think that's what it is, Adam. I don't know if you're stupid or not. I mean, I just think it's because I don't think you are.
Oh, thank you.
You've been around in show business long enough, but then you could be stupid anyway for being in show business for so long.
Yeah, well, either way. I know you could.
One way or another.
What you just said was stupid, ironically. Frank Vincent is on the phone. Frank?
Good morning, Leotardo, Frank.
Bill Leotardo.
Hiya, little pussy.
I'm out here in Los Angeles, 7 o'clock in the morning. Pussy. Isn't this something?
Yeah, that busting balls.
Phil, I should say, Frank delivered a wonderful soliloquy last night. It was beautiful. I think we have it here.
Okay.
In light of recent humiliations, it's an honor to be joined by men. And not cornhole and suckers like married my cousin. He should fucking die.
Whoa, Phil.
Take it easy.
We'll
the one makes you emotional. Because I got an empty fucking stomach. I'm a breadstick.
It's nice to know you're watching.
Hey, Vin, that's Cha-Cha, by the way.
Cha-Cha had a line last night? Cha-Cha's my right-hand man. Cha-Cha had a line last night.
That's a little inside stuff.
Mm, who is Cha-Cha?
He's now my right hand guy, but he's Vinny's guy on the show
on my radio show.
Ah, and they yeah, you do
yeah,
like
whatever, we can't talk about
that. Yeah, you do like a satellite, like a wise guy satellite thing, right?
Yeah, I'm with the guy who used to be here before. I mean, I'm on that show, that station.
And we'll give it a plug. That's fine.
No, I'm not going to do that.
Well, you know, people do that, but it's like if you're giving a TV show a plug, why not give a radio
Big
show
pussy
a plug?
More loyal here than he was to Tony Soprano.
No, I have a radio show back in New York.
It's a wise guy show.
And whatever I don't do it, Frank does it for me. Thank you so much, Frank. In fact, I got to talk to him. I'm going to take a couple of weeks off because I like L.A.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
You're enjoying yourself out
here?
Yeah,
and then Frank does the show for me.
Yeah. Well,
tell us about this Celebrity Fit Club. What is the regiment? How does that go?
Well, I'm inspired by people like Joe Ganascoli, who went on before me. It's you know, you go on and you lose a lot of weight.
Joe Ganascoli is Vito, right?
Vito.
He was on the first Celebrity Fit Club.
Oh, he was.
And you lose a lot of weight. You know, you get back in shape, and it's good, and it brings you out to the West Coast.
Carney Wilson, Erica Laniak, she's the hot blonde.
Nikki Totoro's on with me, Frank.
Oh, good.
Nikki senses love.
Okay, say hello.
Nikki's on.
Tina Yeathers, you guys must be huge fans of Tina Yeathers.
Ted Lang from The Love Boat, but yeah. Nikki sends his love, Frank. Frank worked with Nick Totoro on Federal Hill, and then we did Witness to the Mob. We do all these mob movies together. I wonder why, right, Frank?
Yeah, we've been friends for a long time.
Frank and I have a film out now called This Thing of Oz.
Mm-hmm.
We got a lot of stuff out together.
Also with James Caan, by the way.
Yeah, Jimmy Caan's in that. Right. It's doing well, right, Frankie? You know, I hear you can't get it in the stores.
I heard it's jammed. Yeah, just dropped the shelf.
It's doing good. So I didn't see last night's episode.
Oh, you're going to love it.
Yeah, I was too busy doing push-ups.
And by the way, Vinny is my interview, Vinny, for A Guy's Guide to Being a Man's Man, the cigar.
Yeah, I'm in Frank's book.
Now, let's talk about that quickly. Vincent, let's be open. What happened with the woman? You got busted about a year ago.
Ooh, asking
me?
Tough questions.
I'm not talking about that.
Oh, you're not talking about that.
What are you, nuts?
I don't know. Listen, it came up.
Who brought it up?
Me, I brought it up. Man's Man Guide. I thought it was a natural thing to talk about.
Frank.
I don't know anything
Frank,
about
what
that.
Happened
we don't
with
talk
Vincent.
About it. No, you know why? I'm going to tell you something. You guys want to be crazy? Say something bad. See if you don't get a lawsuit on your hands.
Wow.
That's where it's at right now. So just don't even talk about it.
All right.
Unless
it's
you want to get your ass sued by somebody. Frank. Not by me.
Not by you.
Right, Frank?
Yeah, let's talk about go home and get your shine box.
That's right. Yes. Go home and get your shine box.
I'm going now.
All right, well, speaking of guys getting whacked, Dave Damashek at the top of the list.
Yeah.
But who's next on The Sopranos? What do you guys think?
Well, what do you think?
Me?
No, Adam.
Well, Vito obviously seems like he's at the top of the list.
Yeah, I think so.
But, you know, the whole idea with The Sopranos is get you to think something and then do something else.
Right.
Zig when you're zagging.
Right.
Well, the question is now with Vito, let's say, is it going to be the pancake guy or the Vaz guy?
Oh, the Vaz guy, I think they had a vibe going.
Is that who you're voting on, the Vaz guy?
Yeah, it's an entire gay city, by the way.
Right. Yeah, it's like a mecca.
He went in, too. It really is. It's like Fire Island.
How weird is that? All of a sudden, he took a ride somewhere and ended up in the land of Oz? What happened there?
Right. Yes, he landed up in Felchburg.
That's right. It's David Chase, man.
It was bizarre.
Yeah.
Yeah, all right. Well, I think... I was sort of sad that we didn't get to see him last episode.
Oh, you're going to see him. You're going to see him.
Oh, really?
I promise you that.
Hmm.
And he might be eating more flapjacks.
Okay.
So what has he got, a thing going on with John, the actor John?
Yeah.
That's our buddy.
Yeah.
Which one's John?
The cook.
The flapjack guy?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, he's hot.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
They're gonna happen.
I don't know.
I think they might do the nasty. I don't know.
Well, I was told that Joe gets a little graphic, so...
I heard that, too, yeah.
Oh, really?
Yeah, Tony Sirico's a little upset.
Yeah, I don't know if I'm ready to see the... I don't mind the fellas talking about it, but I'm not sure if I'm ready to see the graphic depiction.
So Tony Sirico, Paulie Walnuts, does not approve of this storyline.
You don't approve about it in real life.
That's what I'm saying.
So Frank...
Yeah.
We think Vincent is coming back. We think he's going to come back in the form of some flashbacks. Yeah.
Well, you know, I mean, I probably think that David might put everybody in the last eight episodes.
That makes sense. That's not a bad idea. Yeah, maybe he may do something. Who knows?
So that, you know.
But the thing is, I'm going to be skinny now.
It's all right. So you'll call you a little pussy.
All right.
Yeah, and by the way, you've been dead for 4 years. You're bound to lose a couple of pounds.
Yeah, the piranha fish will eat away, I think.
Adam, do you realize I have to go in now and loop all that stuff I did last night for regular television?
You didn't do that yet?
No, we didn't do this one yet. No, we're up to 11 and 12.
Oh, no, you got a lot of looping to do, Frank.
Wow.
We have to take all the language out for regular television. Up.
Well, how does... Now, explain that to me. How does that work? Obviously, you have to clean it up for network.
Yeah, it's going on syndication, right.
Ah, and when is it going to start being syndicated?
I heard next year on A&E.
So everything you have done needs to be looped.
Every word.
Yeah, I did my stuff when I was there. So they
all the language, the bad language.
You say freak instead of the other word.
Right. You say freak and, you know, different words.
But it's weird when you watch, like, I can remember watching Smoking the Bandit on TV and hearing Jackie Gleason call him a scumbum thousand times instead of a son of a bitch, which now you can say.
Yep.
So actually... there will be plenty of things you can say. I mean, you can say bitch and whore and God knows what else. You just have to get the S word and the F word out of there, right?
And say the things that Phil Leotardo said last night.
No.
Right. You know,
no.
Some bad things.
No. Yeah. All right. We need to take ourselves a break because we're running late. We got the Ace Young from American Idol coming in here. Yeah,
what,
pretty boy.
Us off the air?
Yeah, it's not going to be so pretty when you're done with him.
All right.
Okay, Adam.
All right, Frank.
Hey, Frank, I'll see you back in New York.
Okay, Vin, call me. Adam, thank you for the plug.
I'm going to plug it again just for you, which is you got this Thing of Ours movie, which is out. You can find it on, I guess you could order it over the internet, but you can go get it at the video store and that kind of stuff,
come
right?
Come downstairs, I got a truck, I'm selling them hot.
James Caan also in that, as well as Vincent Pastore. Vincent, we'll look for you on the Celebrity Fit Club.
Yeah, you may see me running up and down Hollywood Boulevard in my shorts.
With Isaac from The Love Boat.
And Tina Yothers, you better beat her.
Tina, she's a good kid.
All right, but we're just saying, beat her.
We want you to take
beat
her.
Right. I don't
want
to beat anybody.
We don't mean beat.
Not beat.
We don't want a lawsuit. No, I mean, win. Victorious, yeah. You got a lot of Wavos marching in. I don't even know who this dude is, by the way.
Who is he?
I don't know.
Like, he looks like a brother from another planet.
He looks like a dead man to me.
Frank, you still there?
I got rid of him.
What'd you get rid of Frank for?
Well, we got to take a break.
You get rid of me too?
Yes.
All right, Adam. It was real nice being here.
Vincent Pastore,
yeah,
everybody.
I'll go have breakfast now. Thanks for waking me up so early.
All right, just low carb. We'll take a quick break. We'll be right back with Ace Young after this.
And the promise to be near each time you call.
That's a little Ace Young who's on the phone. But first, Vincent Pastore, we decided to bring him back and have him hop on the scale because we've got the Celebrity Fit Club thing coming on. Yeah, it's all balanced out, so hop on there. Vincent will weigh himself in and then come back in a couple of months and we'll get a weight on him.
The scale doesn't work, man.
Oh, yes, it does.
No, it don't.
Oh, what does it say?
I'm guessing it's not light. What are you coming in at?
This is wrong. I'm going to tell you what I was told yesterday. I'm not going to go by the scale.
All right, what is it?
I'll say 274.
What does the scale say, Bryce? Oh, 4 pounds?
I got sneakers and pants and stuff.
Yeah, all right.
So we'll say, I'll be fair, I'll say 275.
275.
275.
I'm telling you, don't go too light, because when you come back...
I'm coming back 240, you are.
240?
That's right.
What year are we in?
240, I'm talking about 3 months. I'm
going to
be
months.
Back 3 months.
Right,
I'm
3 months.
Coming up 240.
All right.
With a nice tan and 2 blondes.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
There he goes. Make haste.
All right.
He's off. They lose the waist.
You heard it. He's coming back here, 240 tan with the Nelson twins.
And then he's going to beat the bejesus out of
him. Be nice when he gets to his ass fighting.
Probably is doing some cardio, and boxing might be something.
Sure, sure.
I don't think he probably needs any further training with the fists to beat the hell out of me.
Ace Young?
Yes, sir.
Good to talk to you.
Someone else who can beat me.
I ran into Ace in the hallways of CBS a few weeks back.
Yeah.
I was excited to see Ace. He was excited to see me.
I was. You are the man of Loveline that I've listened to for a long time.
Wow.
I was very excited to meet you.
So you used to listen to Loveline when you were growing up in Denver?
Yes.
Well, I was excited to meet you and excited to have you on the show this morning, so thanks.
Thank you.
Where are you now? Are you out here in Los Angeles?
I'm actually in New York.
Doing press?
Yes. I just did Regis and Kelly and performed live on that, and now I'm doing a lot of press.
Have you gotten offers to do, modeling, endorsement, your own cologne? Ace.
Ace cologne.
Yeah.
Everything's actually on the way. I've been out of the bubble for 3 days, and opportunities definitely coming in for reality TV, for some movie spots, and for music as well. So I'm just sitting back and seeing my way so I can really figure out where I'm supposed to go here.
Have, a lot of the people who get cut off American Idol usually have their choice between, yes, reality TV and something in music, but you have modeling, I would imagine, too.
I don't even know what's come in yet, so, if it comes, that'd be great.
Now, my wife tells me you're attractive. I don't judge dudes, so I don't know
I'm the youngest of 5 boys. If I start judging, they beat me up.
Yeah, I mean, I see the six-pack abs and the big guns where the arms belong and the dimples and the high cheekbones and the teeth that look like a picket fence.
You're going too far.
No, I don't judge. I don't know that's good
but
looking.
To be fair, you didn't need that. You didn't need your wife to tell you, because Paula Abdul was drooling all over Ace the moment she saw him. Yes, did she throw herself at you behind the scenes?
We only saw the judges actually when we came out to perform. I never got any notes, and never made it to me.
Really?
Yeah.
I'll tell you, she knows. She's well.
Learned
also, women. I mean, obviously, the big joke and the old joke is women really hit their stride somewhere around 35 or 40.
It's just 35 to 80, right?
Yeah, just about the time we're done with them.
No, that's when you get started.
Yeah, that's what they say. But I mean, look. Let's face it. We're basically men. Our jobs are to try to talk 17 and 18 year olds into having sex. Not running from 40-year-olds like Paula Abdul with heart bubbles coming out of her head. So, Ace, what is it? What's on tap for you other than going out on tour with American Idol?
The first thing I want to do is I want to go back to Colorado. I want to party with everybody that's that voted for me and kept me there. And I'm going to definitely give a couple weeks here to Colorado just so I can meet the millions of fans that voted me there.
Especially the 17 or 18-year-old girls that Adam just made reference to.
Well, Adam can go with me, and we'll see if we can run it at night.
Forget him! Yes. How about me?
No, me. I'll tell you.
But guys with, good-looking abs and cheekbones and pecs and arms where they belong.
Yes, you go on a sex tour of Colorado, and then if there's enough fluid left in your body, you cut an album.
Hey, you know what? I'm already working on an album. I'm definitely going to do that no matter what.
Now, let me explain a lot of guys have been doing this lately. Explain that you love the ladies. Explain that you're too young to settle down. And essentially, be upfront with your sexual plans, and everyone will accept it. If you announce, listen, I love ladies too much to settle down with one, or I'm too young, or whatever, then you get to do whatever you want. It's like Snoop Dogg gets to smoke weed wherever he wants because he's announced to the world.
Did he get one of those permits so it's legal?
Yes. I legalize. You know, my plan from the 6 o'clock hour was medical porn.
Oh,
I will get a note from my doctor says I can have porn wherever I want because in a special parking space. Just
well,
like
I hope you do, and I hope that parking space doesn't have too many people watching.
Ace, how big a disparity has it been? Now, you were a good-looking fellow before this whole thing began, but now that you emerge from the bubble, as you call it, now that you've come out on the other side, is it just insane? Is every woman after you now, everywhere you walk?
It's amazing to see all the people that watch the show. I mean, it's all of America.
Not people. I'm talking about foxy young women who are throwing themselves at you.
I got you. well, going through the airport alone, just landing in New York, I had probably 2,000 people say my name from the plane to baggage claim.
Wow.
And it was overwhelming. And I've had the greatest 2 days of my life just because I've had teenagers all the way up to grandparents walk up to me, not say a word, and just give me the most sincere hug I think I've received in my life.
The thing, too, about being a good-looking guy is you can be a good-looking guy and still just have a horrible life and a horrible job. When I used to work construction, I worked with a lot of good-looking guys who basically just carry drywall for a living.
And you were one of them, right?
Thank you, Ace. That's right. Body glistening in the Burbank sun. But seriously, if you're a good-looking woman, if you're a beautiful woman, you will have, that is its own celebrity. And you will get a job as a receptionist at a law firm or something, and you'll be dating one of the guys who's partners at the law firm, and you'll have a decent life. A good-looking guy can toil in obscurity and have a horrible life up until now, yes?
You know what? You have definitely analyzed and overanalyzed.
Yes.
I haven't even thought about it in that depth. So,
well, what was your last job?
I was doing, just before this, I was selling copiers. Yeah, I was doing that and working on music on the side.
Right.
And
your good looks have never, I mean, you're a great-looking guy, but you've always been treated like a guy first, right?
Definitely.
It's not like
definitely.
Doors swing open.
No, I've had many, many clothes, especially trying to sell stuff.
Right.
And now you're making up for lost time, and you're plowing the women of America like a field, yes?
right now, I haven't gotten home yet, so I'm really excited to see everybody. That's for sure.
Well, you don't need to be home to meet a nice young lady.
Yes,
that is true. But I've been swamped. I don't think I've spoken to more than, you know, just three people outside of all the press and everything, and had a deep conversation. So it's been awesome.
Who do you like to win? I know I ask everyone this, and they're careful with their answers, and obviously we're not going to hold you to anything. Who would you like to win, and who do you think will win?
Okay. Well, I'm not going to be careful at all.
Good.
I in the beginning, I thought I was really surprised to see Chris and Paris in the bottom three with me.
Yes, I was as well.
I wore a suit. It was the first suit I ever bought in my life. I performed a classic song, pulled the hair back, and... I was really surprised. I thought that my momentum was picking up, and, you know, I really thought that we were all safe.
Mm-hmm.
When we were announced in the bottom three, I was really surprised they were there, and on top of it, I think it was a good wake-up call for their fans, just to know that their votes really do count.
Mm-hmm.
And in all of that, I would tell you that the week before, Chris and Paris were definitely parts of my... They were my favorites.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought very highly of them. So... After all that, I mean, the only people that haven't been in the bottom three are Kelly and Taylor.
Really? Yeah, that's right.
That's
so
it.
So before we go, a final. Who wins, and who would you like to most see win, or is it the same person?
You know what? I don't know, because right now, last week, Catherine did an amazing job.
Yeah,
he has been in the bottom three. So with something like this, I think that you have your number of fans early on, and they carry you through to the point where, you know, your certain number of fans are ready for you to come out and see them. And that's my time. My time is now to go see the millions of people.
Who would you be angry at if they won?
I would be angry at Ryan Seacrest if he won.
Oh, come on, Ace.
You know what? I don't think I'd be angry at anybody. We've been such a tight family. I'm just flattered to be part of it.
Well, you'll be reunited on the tour. Ace, when you get to L.A., come in the flesh and see us.
I would love to. And, you know, I'll bring a picture that doesn't show everything that we talked about and sign it for your wife.
Thank you.
Bring some of your groupies, too.
Thank you.
And bring some of your hot groupies. Brothers.
Yes, bring a second picture so that I can put a hole in it and really make short work of it. Don't worry about it. All right, Ace Young, everybody. American Idol, of course. We're going to take a quick break. When we come back, we'll do news, sports, yes, after this.
Here's what's not coming up this morning on The Adam Carolla Show.
Tom and Katie's bouncing baby girl. Ranting, raving, totally possessed.
Nick Lachey, his life after Jessica.
Plus, Rockin' Rod and his baby boy. Our busy day with Rachel Ray.
And I'm in the Bahamas with Kelly Clarkson. Plus, where are your favorite idols today?
All right, so none of that's coming up.
Good to know.
All right.
I'm happy that that's the case.
Ozzy's waiting in the wings. He's working on his review of The Sentinel. That should be interesting. Also,
number two at the box office this weekend.
Yes, that's right. That's right. But first, yeah, Landon Donovan, soccer star, is going to be calling in hopefully during, he's already calling in, during, maybe we should talk to Landon now so he doesn't have to hang on.
Yes, it's an exciting time in sports right now. We got the NBA and Stanley Cup playoffs going on. But, of course, this summertime, the world's biggest sporting event, the World Cup.
That's right. Landon?
Hello.
Hello.
How we doing, man?
Good to talk to you.
You too, man.
Landon is forward for the LA Galaxy. Landon, the World Cup is in Germany starting in June, right?
That's it.
And how do we expect to fare as the United States this year?
I mean, I hope good. I hope good. I don't know, man. That's why we play the games, man. I don't know.
Well, I know, but if you finished, let's say, eighth overall, would that be good? I mean, I know you want the you want the victory, but would we be satisfied?
Pretty satisfied. The difference is last time I think we finished eighth and we were satisfied. This time we've got a harder initial group, so I think if we get to that point, we're still doing pretty good.
Italy and the Czech Republic in their little group to start out with.
Mm-hmm.
Two of the
like
best.
The top 10 teams in the world there. So
now, why are these countries dominant? And I'm sure you've been asked this question before. I have an answer, but I'd like to hear your answer.
I want to hear yours.
Well, here's my answer.
Okay.
I've said it before. People say, you know, we have the greatest athletes in the world. Yeah. Why shouldn't we dominate in soccer? Why should we let these little Kazakhstan stands and places like this kick our ass when we have superior athletes? And I say this. It's the same reason they can't drive.
Right.
They grew up on soccer, generation after generation, grandfathers, fathers. And now, when you're driving around Los Angeles and you're behind somebody whose nationality you can't figure out, and you want to know why this guy can't drive, because he rode a donkey here. His grandfather did not have an automobile. His dad did not have an automobile. He's the first guy in his family to get behind the wheel, and it's going to take generations. His kids' kids will be fine drivers. He won't be. We didn't grow up on soccer, but now it has been about 25, 30 years.
I have a feeling
years.
Landon's theory is the exact same.
What do you say, Landon?
It is. I mean, it's a good observation, man. I didn't know you cared enough about soccer.
It's more that I'm passionate about driving and people that drive slowly, but I am. Now, how did you get started in soccer? Did you start at a very, very early age?
Yeah. No, but you're right. When I grew up, it was kind of, I mean, kids have always played, but as I got more serious about it in high school, kids would kind of be like, well, why are you playing soccer? You know, like, what's going on? Why soccer? At that time, there was no league. Our national team had barely been in, like, their first World Cup in 50 years, so people had no idea. But it's getting to the point now where, at least it's in people's conscience a little bit more, and we're getting there, man. We don't have the 100-year history like all the other countries.
Well,
so.
what, Well, what about that? You got, you know, the MLS is doing reasonably well, I guess. What about this right. Freddie Adu character, though?
He's all right, man. He's young, so.
But do you resent him? Because you're really superior player to him, but he gets all
thanks,
the,
man.
Like a year ago, it was all the talk was Freddie Adu is going to make the MLS.
But, I mean, that's not us talking. That's everyone else talking. And can you imagine being 16 with that kind of pressure on your shoulders? The next great radio host at 16, and you're thinking, like, what the hell? You know, how am I? I can't even speak yet. I can't even... I'm just learning how to kiss girls, and people tell me I'm the next great hope. So,
thankfully, when I was 16, I was living in the garage.
There you go.
My stepmother let me live in and working. My biggest pressure was which shift to work over at the McDonald's. Do I do the mornings or I do the afternoons?
Just think from like a... Just from where you are mentally at that stage to be have that put on you.
Yeah,
tough,
I think
man.
I think he, you know, obviously that Freddie was a phenom at 14 and all his life, really. But playing professional sports at 15 is crazy. But do you think he will develop into one of the all-time greats? Is he going to be better at 22, 23?
Yeah, I think it's up to him because nobody denies that he has the talent. And in sports, you see it all the time. People much more talented don't make it because they don't have the right mental makeup. So if he wants to, he could be the best player in this country ever for sure, mm-hmm. and one of the best ever in the world. Hmm. But it's up to him.
Is it fun, Landon, playing in Europe as opposed to the United States? Is there a big difference?
The difference is you get the games, the stadium, the atmosphere is different, and it's consistently different, and that's the difference. And we have a few games a year that are like that. We played against the team, the Chivas team, the other week, and it was like that down at Home Depot. It was like that. There was 27,000, and it was a constant just buzz in the air, and the atmosphere was awesome. But we don't have enough of those games there. It's every game, every week, no matter who you're playing.
Right. And that must be nice. Like, on one hand, well, you don't get to do it in front of your hometown fans. On the other hand, it must be nice to have 105,000 drunken, screaming people with their shirts off.
Exactly.
Just out of their mind over your sport.
Right. No, it's there's nothing like it, man. That's why you like to play, because it's people care and you can see it in their faces.
So what the key is that they got to get a guy like Beckham, somebody like this, to come over and play alongside of Donovan, and then this will be.
I don't know, man. They've tried that in the past, bringing in big time players, and there was a league before us that failed. Because they're spending too much money on it, so I don't know the answer. But
I'll tell you what the answer. This is what would do it for most Americans. You guys put a helmet on and start carrying that ball instead of kicking it and bashing into each other. Yeah. And then after you knock each other down, do a crazy dance. Whatever you call it, I'm saying that's what Americans. We want to see people running into each other and then dancing.
You got to come up with some details on this little sport you've created. It could be something.
Well, we take the goal and we turn it upside down so that the prongs stick up into the air. That's
you want to be the commissioner, man?
Yes.
You got a future.
You're be the commissioner of soccer.
Jeez.
That's right. All right, Landon, I want to thank you for calling into the show.
Donovan, guarantee victory at the World Cup.
Please.
Here we go.
Please.
Do it. Get it on. Well, let's get it recorded now, and then we'll play it back for all of time.
Guaranteed in 2014.
All right.
All right.
That.
All right.
All right. Cool.
All right, Landon, thanks a lot, buddy.
All right, guys.
Talk to you soon. Landon Donovan, soccer star, LA Galaxy's forward.
Best American, they say.
Yeah?
Yeah.
They do say
best American
that.
Player, yeah.
And he was the opposite of a trash talker. Very humble.
But you could tell when you brought up Beckham and Freddie that these guys are never fans of their own. You know what I mean?
That's do.
Like, yeah. Morning radio show hosts don't like other morning radio show. Doctors don't like other doctors. Nobody likes whoever does what they do. It's kind of interesting.
Yeah, it was a little bit of a half-hearted, well, I wish him the best.
You know who does? Teachers. Teachers like other teachers for some reason. Oh, if you don't make that much money and nobody cares, then you do. Like garbage men and teachers, they like the other garbage men, the other teachers. But once you make over a certain amount, you hate the other people who are in your field. It's interesting. I wonder what that amount is.
Well, this
probably
Donovan,
about 80 grand.
This Donovan's got nothing to be low about. He's a lady killer.
Mm.
Really?
The women swoon for him. Yeah, oh yeah, oh yeah.
Great thighs.
I wasn't expecting
that. I heard
that,
girlfriend. So here, I can't judge. I don't judge
a
man's
look. Well, soccer players do have good legs.
Mm-hmm. All right.
Yes.
We were going to do the news. Are we going to do the news, or we're going to take a break? All right, we're going to take a break. Then we'll do news and sports after this.
And now, Oswaldo reads the 100 greatest movie quotes of all time. From The Wizard of Oz.
Toto. I be go feeling we're not in Kansas anymore.
Wow, not in cancer anymore.
Adam Carolla Show.
Toto. Not in cancer anymore. Oswaldo Castillo. My old buddy Ozzy in studio.
Bearded now.
You're going to review a movie coming up for us shortly. What is the name of that movie?
The Sentinel. With Michael Douglas.
Michael Douglas is in that one. All right. Who else is in that? Do you know?
Yeah, good.
Oh, it's good. Okay. All right. So hang back. We'll bring you in. You'll do the Sentinel. But first, we have news and sports starting with news and Teresa Strasser.
In an audio tape broadcast on Arab television yesterday and believed to be authentic, Osama bin Laden accused the United States of supporting a, quote, Zionist war on Islam. He also called for a global Muslim boycott of American goods. This was the first new message from the Al-Qaeda leader in 3 months.
Well, what would they do if they boycotted American goods, considering they don't really have any goods?
They'd be goodless.
They just have to live off Chinese goods or whoever goods. Yeah. Yes, see how far you get eating camel dung and in dates every night.
He wants to keep talking. He's going to talk himself right into the jerk report.
Wow, uh-oh. Bin Laden.
Think he's cruising for the jerk report?
It's as though he's asking to be placed on the jerk report.
I really thought this was a day and age where we could find anybody on the planet at any time. I don't know what the over-under for Bin Laden, you know, once we announce we're going to find this guy and bring him to justice, the over-under for me was about 3 weeks.
Yeah.
I can't believe we're going on year 5 of not being able to find this guy and the a-holes who were in charge. And yes, I'm talking about the Bill Clintons of the world that had this guy in his crosshairs when we had a shot, should have squeezed the trigger. There were many times we could have squeezed the trigger on this guy. And let this be a message to all the pusses out there that are thinking twice about squeezing the trigger for the next Bin Laden. Squeeze it. We wouldn't have to go through this mess.
Shoot now. Let God sort out
the rest. That's right. Let Allah sort them out.
Entertainment news.
It's a good T-shirt. I'd like that T-shirt.
I'm
kill
sure
them all.
Exists.
Let Allah sort them out. Oh, yeah. Oh, actually, Big Tad's showing me he's wearing one.
Oh,
that's
great.
Where I got it.
Comes in an extra large. Okay. Comedian Sacha Baron Cohen, best known as Ali G, has gotten some flack in the past from the Kazakhstan government because of his character, a Kazakhstan reporter named Barat. Mm-hmm. Now, the daughter of the Kazakh president is sticking up for Sacha Baron Cohen, saying, quote, we should not be afraid of a little humor. Now, here is Barat, the character, singing about his problem with the Jews.
Throw the Jew down the well.
I heard Toby Keith cover this one, but I never heard the original.
So, that was great.
Everybody with the lighters in concert. If you ever see Keith, when he goes in to throw the Jew down the well, the lighters come out.
Well,
not
it is
surprising
catchy.
He did. Moving. Borat sang it for a bunch of rednecks in some Texas.
And
bar.
They all started singing along. It was the scariest thing I've ever seen. They didn't realize it was a joke. And they're at the country western bar and they start singing along.
I didn't even know that Kazakhstan actually exists. I thought it was one of those made up places, number one. Number two, what year are we in that we have to explain humor to the rulers
to the
of these nations?
Kazakhs.
You know, yes. How does that work? And by the way, really, are you more reptile than man when you really have to explain? I mean, when you think about the creatures of the world that have no sense of humor.
Right.
Iguanas, any lizards, snakes, alligators, last I checked. The more you evolve, the more you have humor. It's an evolutionary thing. You know, people look at it as, well, it's a choice you make. No, the smarter you are, the more you're able to absorb, the more you're able to appreciate, the greater your sense of humor. When you're stupid, you don't have much of a sense of humor. And if you keep going down the food chain, you know, as you go, you get the chimpanzees like to screw around. There are other animals that are sort of dolphins and things like that at play. And then you get to the reptiles. and there's no humor going on. Insects and reptiles, no humor in that world. Well, go ahead. Let's go find the Middle East and figure out where they work on that animal flow chart.
You're putting them at the unicellular level.
Yes,
like animals.
The one cell somewhere between the arachnopods and the reptilians.
Throw the Jew down the well, though, is very catchy, and unfortunately, you might find yourself singing it later, and that doesn't go over well. Am I right? It's catchy.
It's a foot tapper, yeah. Well, you know, I got kids on the way, and I'm looking for a lullaby that's a little off the beaten track. Perhaps I do that one. Enough with the itsy bitsy spider going down the spout. That's not going to serve him any good.
Right.
Yeah.
Ice cream makers Ben and Jerry's have issued an apology for naming a new flavor Black and Tan, which is the nickname of a violent British militia that was active during Ireland's War of Independence. The ice cream is based on an ale and stout drink of the same name. A spokesman for the company apologized this morning at a press conference.
With regard to our new flavor Black and Tan, we at Ben and Jerry's sincerely apologize for reference to the British Army unit. It was absolutely unintentional, and no ill will was ever intended. And in light of this, we have recalled other flavors that may be considered offensive. Those flavors are Chubby Alcoholic Abusive Hubby, Mississippi Mud People, KK Cake Batter, Chunky AIDS Spreading Monkey, and Hitler Was Right Oatmeal Crunch.
Wow, I didn't see that one.
Free sample of Osama Bin Lemon Cobbler.
Huh.
Well, it takes a big company to admit when they're wrong.
Yeah. It was unintentional.
Mm-hmm.
Saturday at a wedding reception in Ohio, the bride's father and stepfather got into a fight about who was going to cut the cake. The stepfather of the bride stabbed the bride's father.
Well, we have a front runner for definitely not a Jew.
This is why I put this in the news. I thought, I wonder if Adam is going to predict that these people were not Jews.
I will predict that they've never been thrown down a well.
Can we hear it just one more? No, it's
still please.
Okay.
It's finger popping music. Yeah, that is a hell of a wedding in Ohio when you stab the guy at the cake. Hey, you know the other part about the wedding? The part where they mash the cake in
yes.
the face of the whoever? I didn't have to tell the old lady. She knew by the way I looked at her there'd be no face cake mashing at the reception. It seems like a good time until you realize you have another 4 or 5 hours and then it's off to the airport for the honeymoon and whatever, and you have cake all over a rented tux.
It's interesting. It went unspoken between my bride and myself. It was no discussion. No, really? You're not going to slam the cake in my face. But, yeah, you just was understood. That's retarded. Let's not waste good cake.
Yeah, plus, right. Yeah. And then what about the folks like you know, Big Tad who have to eat the cake with your face imprint mashed into it? That's the one I really feel sorry for.
Well, unfortunately, in Ohio, both the bride's stepfather and brother were charged with assault. And stabbing that's no way to end a wedding.
Let's hope they have a big family.
Yes. Often there's tension at weddings, but it doesn't usually come to knife play.
Yeah.
This weekend at the box office, Silent Hill knocked off Scary Movie 4, raking in over $20 million. An interesting point about Silent Hill and actually a lot of the big hits in the last few months, not reviewed.
Mm.
They did not allow critics to see the movie Silent Hill.
Sure. They thought it was that good and would create too big a buzz and that someone might get hurt at the movie theater. No, and also, they haven't even really run too many commercials or anything for that movie. I'm surprised it was number one. It just tells me that people are stupid and they want to see bad, scary movies. And like I said, that whole cop-out thing where you have the little girl who's going, Mommy has to die. It's such a cop-out. Please stop it.
I did get a review this morning from producer Angie,
mm-hmm.
and she said it sucked.
Mm.
I think those were her words.
Yeah, but what? Like I said, it's genius. You just spend $8 million and you make $20 million on the first weekend, and it's
conversely,
done.
That movie American Dreams came in eighth place.
Yeah, it was a surprising tank. I think it made something like under $4 million.
I thought it was going to be the first big smash of the year.
I did too.
Well,
eighth place.
By the way, it's not a good sign when Benchwarmers beats you by $4 million.
Benchwarmers is now probably crossing the $75 million mark in box office receipts. I mean, it is incredible.
Also, they didn't let the critics see that one before it opened.
Well, again, it was too good. I saw it.
Too good.
Too good. And what it was demoralizing creatively. You thought to yourself, well, I'll never create again.
Right.
I'll never be able to top this.
It's the Citizen Kane of our day.
It is.
The Sentinel at number 3 with $14.7 million. We'll hear a review of that coming up shortly. I'm looking forward to it. I'm Teresa Strasser, and that's the news.
It's time for Dave Damashek's number 1 sports. Number 1 sports. Do it, Dave.
I mentioned earlier, this is a spectacular time of the year to be a sports fan. You got baseball underway, you got NBA playoffs, and you got Stanley Cup action to enjoy. It's wonderful. Mixed bag for fans of pro hoops in L.A. this weekend, though. Yesterday, L.A.'s favorite team, the Kobe's, paid a visit to Steve Nash, the Duncan Gorilla, and the rest of the Phoenix Suns. A lot of Lakers played very well. Lamar Odom.
The Duncan Gorilla should be able to get in for right. some mop-up time in the fourth quarter.
Right. Really embarrass the other team.
I would really...
A somersault dunk right at the end.
I'll tell you, if they would put... They should have a thing where your mascot has to get some minutes in the fourth quarter. He doesn't have to shoot. He doesn't have to pass. He has to be out there. The two teams' mascots guarding each other.
Who would the Lakers be? They don't really have one. Would they use like
Paul Abdul?
Penny Marshall, I was hoping for.
But. Oh, Penny Marshall would be nice.
You could take the gorilla.
Yeah, Marshall, Abdul, or we could free Rainbow Head from his prison. Get him out right there.
Guy's in the clink, the John 316 fella.
Sure.
But anyway, like I was saying, a lot of the Lakers played well. Lamar Odom, Luke Walton, and Kwame Brown, unfortunately, the only Laker who makes any difference, Kobe Bryant, did not have a good game. Suns get good games out of their stars, plus Tim Thomas, a bum. They win it by 5. Meantime, on Saturday night, L.A.'s best pro basketball team, the Clips, successful in their first game of the playoffs. They held on to put down the visiting Nugs. The Clips play again tonight at 7:30. Lakers and Suns off till Wednesday. Kings of Schwartz and Ento try to redeem themselves tomorrow night after being shamed something awful by the defending champion Spurs.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Stanley Cup playoffs also underway. Anaheim Ducks winners last night to even their series at 1. And the San Jose Sharks did the same against the Nashville Predators yesterday, thanks largely to 1 goal and 2 assists from a man named Jonathan...
Chichu!
Jonathan Chichu, there he is. He turned his team around. Everyone's singing his praises. He won the regular season scoring crown, and now he's trying to take the Sharks to new heights. National pastime. Halos beat the Athletics yesterday. They took 2 of 3 up in Oakland over the weekend. But it was a battle. These two teams are going to fight it out all season long for the
ALS.
What
are they? How are the Halos doing?
They're
this
tied
year?
For first.
So they're 7.5 and 7.5.
Listen, I don't want to start the week off with you bad-mouthing the national pastime again.
I'll tell you.
Well, you can go talk about soccer again if you please.
All right. Well,
is that what you wish?
Maybe I have a point. But how are they doing? Are they above 500?
I think they're just now 10-9. I think they've just now turned the corner.
I'll tell you, I'm hanging on every game.
All right. The worst team.
It's all critical.
Oh, they're over 500 and in first place? What
That's
a
right.
sport.
The Mariners, they lost to the Tigers. They're the worst team in the division. Barry the Creep Bonds and his pals lost to the Rockies. But on Saturday night, Barry hit his first home run of the season. Muzzle tough to you, Creep. Let's check the standings. Let's check the home run standings. Bronson Arroyo, the pitcher for the Reds, has 2.
Mm-hmm.
Barry the Creek
Ex-Reds.
Bonds.
He was ex-Reds pitcher,
no, he was
right?
on the Red Sox. Now he's on the Reds. That's
oh,
where
oh
got
I'm sorry. He was
on
Sox of the Reds. Right.
Right. So Arroyo with 2. Bonds with 1. Damashek with 0. Aww.
So you guys are pretty close.
Neck and neck and neck right now. Well, it's anyone's game.
How close are you to the Babe's record, though? Of home runs.
Well, that's still I'm a ways down from that yet. But that's not what we're talking about. And someone else just made the list for a possible jerk report coming up later.
Mm.
All right. Dodgers beat the Snakes in Chavez Ravine yesterday. Padres beat the Mets. I paid a visit to Petco Park, as I told you I was going to, over the weekend. Petco Park, I watched them lose to the Metropolitans on Saturday, but they won yesterday. It's a lovely place.
Yeah.
It's really nice.
No
and
pets allowed, ironically.
I know. It's a horrible name for a place.
You couldn't bring your dog into Petco Park.
Right. Well, they have also the other thing about
Petco. By the
Petco,
way, it's got the word Petco and Park. right in it. Dogs must really be confused standing outside that place.
Standing outside talking about the sad irony.
Not only is it the park, it's got the word pet in it.
Yeah, but I will say this for Petco. You know I like to eat the foods when I go to the various ballparks. Delicious hot dogs. Gigantic, too. Like foot long, legitimate foot long and fat, too. It almost looked like it's too much dog for one person, but the point is delicious.
Well, Damashek has told me privately many times that he enjoys girth in the wiener. More than length.
No, he said that's the important thing.
He's a huge fan of girth in the weenie department. And he's just, you know, he's a weenie fan.
Well, let me tell you two more things quickly. One is that speaking of San Diego sports, their mayor, Jerry Sanders, says that let the Chargers go. We're not paying for them to have a new stadium, the Chargers, so they can go look around for the rest of this calendar year in San Diego County. And if nobody builds them a stadium outside of the city, then they're free to go. I think this is, I know it comes up all the time, I think this is LA's best chance of getting a team. I think LA is going to have the Chargers in two seasons or less. Mm-hmm. And I think it's going to be fun for us to get season tickets and go to the games.
Mm.
What a fun time that'll be.
Didn't the Chargers used to be in Los Angeles or something like it, or am I making that up? Were they always in San Diego?
They've been down there for 45 years.
They started there.
Yeah.
And not left.
Bambi, Lance Allworth.
Yes.
When they wore the lovely powder blue.
Oh, the best.
The white hats with the numbers on it. That's a nice looking uniform.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what they got to go back to. And now, speaking of uniforms, one more thing quickly is, did you hear about the American Football League with this team, the Birmingham Steel Dogs, which is a lousy name for a team?
Yes.
They are going to have, coming up next week, Faith Night. At their game, it's Faith Night, and instead of the players' names on the back of the jerseys, Bible verses.
Really?
And on the front, instead of the name Steel Dogs, Samson.
Oh.
Really?
What gives?
And just the idea that then they probably spell dogs with a Z at the end of it. Don't put dogs or cats at the end of your stupid expansion team name. It makes you look like amateurs.
Bobcats. Right.
Yes. And don't do the, you know, ice dogs, you know, if you're doing the hockey thing. Don't put this thing you play on and then put dogs at the end of it. It's retarded. It shows no imagination. It's like a retarded 11-year-old won a competition for the worst name, and you guys put it on your jerseys. I'm offended as an atheist that they're doing this. And I know my friends that were thrown down the well are as well. Yes?
Yes, shame on them for having Faith Night. That's ridiculous. So my country can be free. Faith Night at a football.
Dave Damashek's number one sports.
All right, Ozzy.
I ain't going to.
Hold on a second now, Ozzy. Please.
What happened?
Chomping at the bit.
He's drunk. I pointed to Ozzy to let you know, and he thought I cued him.
Well, don't point at Ozzy. Ozzy, you all right?
Yeah.
You had some beer this morning?
No.
Okay.
I am in medication.
You're on medication. Okay.
What kind?
High blood pressure.
Budweiser.
What's the medication for?
High blood pressure.
High blood pressure. Yeah. What's up, Ozzy?
Too much bacon.
Mm-hmm.
Too much, you know, a lot of funky food, you know.
Right. I thought most of you people were vegan.
I know. Keep you know the diet. You know.
I know.
Crazy. Drink too much soda. Too much drink. Too much beer.
Yeah. No. What a shocker that folks that subsist off of nothing but cheese and beef would have some problem with the blood pressure. You got to work some vegetables into the diet, Ozzy. You're too much of the beef and the cheese and the tortillas.
I cut the chief. I don't cut the beef.
Right.
The beef is my life.
All right. Well, tell us before you cut the cheese again. All right, Ozzy, you are going to read a quote from a famous movie. You people at home are going to guess the quote, and you're going to call in. And if you win, oh, wait a minute. Larry says the Chargers started in L.A. Larry?
Hey, Damashek, you're wrong. They played at the Coliseum before they moved to San Diego.
So what?
Yeah. Didn't I say that? Brusca.
Yeah, but still.
You didn't know that either?
I didn't know.
All right.
Yeah. They started? Are you positive they started
at
the L.A. Coliseum? Really?
It sounds familiar.
It sounds right.
They moved down to Balboa Stadium, then they went to the Murph.
Wow.
Right.
But they've been down there for 45 years, right?
Yeah, since the 60s.
Right, but they started in L.A.
Yeah, I think they had 3 seasons in L.A. before they
Thank
came
you.
Down.
This is how my life goes, by the way.
Wow, that's, you know what? I look it up online. 1960, the Los Angeles Chargers. First teams in the AFL. I'm sorry. Yes.
Dave Damashek and his number two sports.
Listen, let me just tell you something. Like Jerry Orbach and Dirty Dancing at the end. No. When I'm wrong, I say I'm wrong, and I'm wrong in this case.
All right.
So be it.
Thank you, Larry.
All right, have a good day.
You know what, Larry?
Yeah.
You want a Hooters gift certificate for $50?
Hey, that's
or my
good.
Job. Choose one or the other.
I'll take the Hooters. I don't want to get yelled at.
Yeah.
Oh.
Nice job, Larry. All right, hang on. I gave away one. We're going to give away another.
See, Bruska? Everyone's afraid to come in here because they're going to get yelled at by you.
Ozzy is going to read the quote, the famous movie quote from the famous movie. You call in and tell us. We're going to take a break after that. Yeah. But you call in and tell us. Well, not yet.
Hold on.
You call in and tell us what the movie is and what the quote is.
Right.
And then you'll get yourself a $50 gift certificate. Or you just call in and shame Dave Damashek and I'll give you $50. All right, Ozzy, you ready?
Ready.
Here we go.
I am going to make him an offer he can refuse.
Seems straightforward, but we'll see if we have a winner after this.
I say Adam, and he says
Adam.
I say Hoffman, and he says
Osman.
Adam,
Adam.
Hoffman,
Osman.
That's just how Oswaldo talks. I say racist, and he says
racist.
I say confusion, and he says
confusion.
Racist,
racist.
Confusion.
Confusion.
That's just how Oswaldo talks.
Yes, it is. The Ozman is here with a review. First, Ozzy, repeat the very difficult movie trivia question we gave out just before the break.
I am going to make him an offer he can't refuse.
Well, it's tough, but I think we have
a
winner.
There's a prize on the line for this.
$50 over at Hooters. Yes, Alex?
Yeah, I think it's the Godfather, part one.
Ah, yes, that would be correct. You want to do the line for us?
We're going to make him an offer. He can't refuse.
Yeah, whoa.
That's good.
Never heard the Brando impression before.
Rare.
Very rare. That and Jimmy Stewart. Those are the two you never hear.
Never hear Pacino.
Nicholson.
All right, Alex. Hang on.
All right, thanks a lot, man.
Thanks there, brother, man. All right, so Ozzy, and by the way, this Justin Benchwarmers has made $47.1 million.
The apocalypse is coming.
Doing quite nicely, thank you. Ozzy, you have a review of what movie?
The Sentinel with Michael Douglas.
Mm-hmm. And you saw it over the weekend?
Yep.
How was it?
Very good movie.
Ooh, very
Numero
good.
Numero Trace at the box office this past weekend.
I don't know what number for I see the movie.
Well, what I'm really hoping for is that Eva Longoria can get a little press out of the deal. You know, it'd be nice to turn on entertainment shows, you know, Access Hollywood and so forth, and see if we could see something on her. She's
like,
a mystery
who's
woman.
She dating?
Who's she dating? What is she wearing? I don't know where she goes. I don't know what she does. I'd like to find something about this riddle known as Eva Longoria. Perhaps, Pat O'Brien, if you're listening, maybe you could dedicate just a few precious seconds of the show to Eva Longoria. I'd love to find out what she's all about. Yeah, who's she dating? Is she dating anyone? I don't know.
It's a mystery.
Is she married and a mother of three? Is she dating some kind of celebrity? Is she, in fact, even straight? Maybe she's not heterosexual. I don't know.
How does she stay so thin? I don't know.
How does she stay fit? What is her fat? What are her workout secrets? What kind of fashion does she enjoy? Please tell us these things about Eva Longoria, because I am an Eva Longoria void. I'm a black hole. I don't know. And I go down the street, you know, because I'm looked at as a Hollywood insider. People turn to me, family members and friends. Hey, Adam, you're in the Hollywood community. Yeah, what questions? Any questions? How about Eva Longoria? Oh, I don't know. I turn into a huge question mark. I don't know. How tall is she? I don't know. How much she? What are her fashion tips and secrets? Is she dating? I don't know. Perhaps if the news shows, if the entertainment news shows, if any of you are listening,
who's
you could dedicate.
Longoria's new gal pal.
If you could just dedicate just a couple of moments to Eva Longoria tonight, it would really make my week.
Well,
I'd love to find out about her.
She's a Garbo-like recluse.
Yes, she's really the Howard Hughes of the Desperate Housewives cast. I know nothing of her. I imagine she's in aviation. That's all I know. All right, Ozzy?
Well, I'm excited to hear this review because it got mixed reviews. Some say very good, some say very bad. So this is the one that will
break. All right,
well,
this is the one I go with.
Yeah. Oswaldo, tell us about some movies. We want to know which movies you have seen. Go ahead, Oswaldo, tell us.
Good morning. The
good
movie
morning.
That I saw this weekend was The Sentinel.
Mm-hmm.
Starring Michael Douglas is Pete Garrison.
Pete who?
Garrison.
Pete Garrison.
Kiefer Sutherland is David Breckenridge.
David who?
Breckenridge.
Breckenridge.
Wait, who's the actor?
Yep.
Who?
Who?
Kiefer?
What is it?
The name of the actor.
Kiefer Sutherland.
All right.
Okay.
It's David Buckley.
All right.
Eva Longoria is Jill Marin.
Eva Longoria. Wow, I really like to really solve that puzzle.
Kim Basinger.
Yeah, who is she?
Is the Fear Lady, Sarah Valentine.
Who?
Kim Basinger.
Ah, okay.
Is the Fear Lady, you know, Sarah Valentine.
Let me ask you this. Don't you think that one out of every 1,000 names he would pronounce correctly just out of a coincidence?
Right.
Do you know what I mean?
Broken clock is right twice a day.
Right. Is it possible to mispronounce everybody's name? And by the way, how do you know how we pronounce it and then pronounce it the other way?
Sorry, Alan.
All right. Oh, don't make me feel bad.
Oh, man.
How about Antonio Banderas?
Antonio Banderas?
Ooh.
That's correct. Better than we could do.
How about Senor Wences?
Senor Wences?
Okay. Thank you. I can't think of any other famous Mexican actors.
And Martin Donovan is William Monroe, the traitor.
Mm-hmm. The traitor.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
The film is based in the sequel to the novel about the guy who saved the president of the United States of America, Mr. President Ronald Reagan, 20 years ago.
Wow.
Pete Warrington is supposed to be the truth president guy.
Mm-hmm.
He is the last line of defense in the Secret Service.
Secret Service, yeah.
He is the most decorated agent in the history.
Agent?
Agent, yeah.
Agent.
Agent.
Mm-hmm.
In the history.
Mm-hmm.
He is also the adulterer.
He's an adulterer?
Yeah. He, you know, make a sex with the first lady.
He makes sex with the first lady?
The Sancho guy.
Who's the Sancho guy?
Sancho guy in Spanish, you know, conocime, you know, the...
Oh, really?
Make the wife to the other guy.
Oh, Sancho's the other guy.
Yeah.
Interesting. That's the guy who's cheating on your old lady.
Yeah, the old lady.
Okay.
My favorite part, you know, is when you use his knowledge and skill to prove he's innocent.
Mm-hmm.
He need to find the traitor and the real group, the assassin.
Mm-hmm.
In closing, the Sentinel left the reviewer cold.
Wow.
Look how happy he is, too, when he does that. The chili thing.
Yeah. Somebody's cruising for a Latin Emmy. His name is Oswaldo.
That's me.
How about Roberto Clemente?
Roberto Clemente.
Nice.
That's good.
Raul
Baseball
Julia.
Player.
Raul Julia.
Robert Julia.
Nice. Jimmy Smits.
Jimmy Smith.
Nah, see, Jimmy screwed you up on that one. Geraldo Rivera.
Geraldo Rivera.
Yeah. Said with gusto. All right, Ozzy. Nice work, buddy.
You should know, Ace, before you judge Ozzy too harshly, not that you are, but he did, as I... I asked him several weeks back. I said, "Who's your favorite people?" I asked him to rank everybody at the show, 1 through 10.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so, certain people. Angie, the producer, she got an 8. He likes her a lot.
Mm-hmm.
I think I got a 7 or an 8, something like that. He doesn't like Brusco. Only got a 5.
That's not true. What
that
I
is
get?
True. He got a 5. That's what you got.
Yeah.
But Adam got 11.
Really?
Wow. Yes. He said Adam's a good man. He said Adam's a good man. And I said anybody better than that? Lynette. Lynette got a 12. Adam's wife got a. He likes Lynette better than you.
Yeah. Thanks, Ozzy. Big thumbs up to you, my brother. Sure. What's nice to like? All right, Ozzy. Nice work as usual.
Yeah, thank you.
Salma Hayek. Say that one.
Salma Hayek.
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 I'll try to fool him. Hayek.
Salma Hayek.
Okay.
Well, wait a second. Very quickly, I just want to say that. I don't want to start any trouble or anything. But what if his favorite person, Lynette, when those twins come out, what if they look like Ozzy?
Oh, interesting. With a Mexican Jerry curl and a beard.
Well, you
the twins leave this reviewer cold.
You tell to me I am Sancho for us?
Yeah.
Oh, he's not Sancho.
Accusing him of being the Sancho.
All right, we'll take a break. Oh, before we take a break, Mark the Poet has been on hold for since about 6 a.m. Mark the Poet.
Yeah, good morning, Adam.
Good morning, Mark. Sorry you've been on hold the entire show.
No worries. Thank you.
You have a poem about baby names?
I do, just for you.
All right.
The Ace Man wants to name the kids. Time to use the noodle. There's a lot of Matt and Sarah's. We need Kit and Caboodle. Mm-hmm. For a boy, how about Cassius? Kane or Constantine? Give him Corleone and he'll be king of the scene. For a girl, there's always Catherine, Candace, Courtney, or Tali, Cassandra or Carnation. Would naming her queen be folly? Mm-hmm. You always get endorsements with a kid named Coca-Cola. Toyota's not a Chevy. Central Broadcast System, Corolla. I'm sure you'll find honorable names. Their birth, the blessing begins. Oh, and has anyone thought that Gemini Adam is having himself some twins?
Wow. Hey, Mark, that was actually fairly solid.
Well, thank you.
I'm sure my cousin nice Brandon in Harrisburg is already begun dashing off a poem against Mark.
That would be nice. It's always a little bit insulting when somebody says, you know what, that did not blow huge ass. I could remember when teacher said to me, you know, you got a C on that test. Did you copy somebody? Yeah. Thank you. Thank you for the slap in the face. Corleone Corolla. Not bad. Ooh. Ironically, saw Godfather last night. Just sitting, skimming through the cable stations. Wife saw it and announced the boy's name was going to be Sonny Corolla. So it's funny that 9 hours later, somebody is going with the Corleone Corolla. I'll take it as that and then ignore it. All right, we'll take a quick break. We'll be right back after this.
Baby names, he needs boy and girl twin baby names. Adam's wife has two buns in the oven, a result of the Ace Man's loving. He must have bionic sperm, 'cause now they're bringing two babies to term. Baby names, baby names. Just give them a call with your baby.
I was walking my dog yesterday and ran into a woman who was walking her dog. And it's always uncomfortable, especially if you don't like people like I do. That when you start walking at the same pace, what are you going to do? Just stop and count to 10, let them get ahead of you? Or just pick your pace up like you're trying to make a flight? And then that seems really weird and rude. Every once in a while, you're out walking the dog and somebody will step off their porch and walk down the stairs or whatever it is and join you seamlessly. And then once you start talking, that's it. Pray the dog's got to drop a deuce so you can get away from him. I mentioned to her that the old lady was pregnant with twins. She fired back with she had 2 uteruses.
Really?
Yes. I thought, wow, we're barely 4 steps into this walk, and I already know so much about you.
Her innards.
Yes.
That's when you pretend to tie your shoe, thus putting her on a different walking pace.
I think she would have stopped. She then explained she wanted to do comedy, and I knew I was in trouble. I fired back with, I have 2 penises, by the way. I just figured, you know what? She'll never know.
Now, when people run into each other, when strangers run into each other and the dogs start to sniff each other, people always make the horrible joke about, oh, look, they like each other, they're dating each other. Are you going to, with twin babies, now everybody who has a baby roughly the same age as your baby, they always say, oh, they're going to be dating in a few years, these two. Oh, look, they're going to spend, you know. Because you have twins, now will you be removed from that joke, or will you have to deal with it twice as much now?
I'm putting a new twist on it, which is they'll be dating each other. Sounds weird, but we're atheists.
You'll nip that joke in the butt if you make it once. People, we intend for them to be together forever.
Yes. Look, I love myself. My wife loves herself. What better way to keep the sort of gene pool alive than have them turn on each other? Fantastic. Kelly?
Yes, sir.
Two uteruses. You have a name for my unborn children?
Yes, I do. Now, they're not gender specific.
All right.
But once you hear them, you'll probably know which one to give the girl.
All right.
All right. With Hollywood in mind as a middle name, I'm going North and West.
That's right. The boy will get West Hollywood.
So yeah, you don't want to do that.
He's gay, yeah. Interesting. Name after my hometown, North Hollywood Corolla.
Right. The short, you know, and you can shorten up by no-ho for the girl.
Yeah.
And,
which is nice. No-ho. She's no-ho.
Yeah, right. Well done. Yeah.
Yeah, but it could be one of those who's on first thing, because they go, oh, what are your kids' name? Well, she's no-ho. Fantastic. Now, what's her name? You know what I mean?
Yeah, but if it's no-ho, if she's no-ho, then the shortened name around L.A. for West Hollywood, though, is WeHo, and that's gay.
Mm-hmm.
So then your son, if he's West Hollywood and he's WeHo, then that means that he's gay.
She's no-ho, he's WeHo?
Right.
Interesting. All right, all taken under consideration. Now we have Billy Moses in studio.
Yes, sir.
Billy 7. I love the sound of your voice.
Thank you.
Billy is 17 years old. He's a huge fan of mine, so much so he followed me into the bathroom on Friday.
Oh, man.
He wanted me to talk to his friend on the cell phone. He yelled no way for the first 10 minutes. That's all right. Billy is a student over at Rio Hondo High School. What is it?
Buena Vista High School.
Buena Vista High School. Prom season is coming up. You're our assistant webmaster.
Yes, I am.
How does that work?
Basically, it's just controlling all of the web-based stuff. You know, about you and the show.
Well, give us a plug. Where should people go if they're on the computer?
You can go to adamcarolla.com. Also, we have a MySpace account, myspace.com/AdamCarolla.
And they can find out anything relevant to the show, like how to misspell Dave Damashek's name.
Hey, yeah, assistant webmaster. Maybe my name could get spelled properly on the website.
I am so sorry about that.
Now go home and get your fucking shine
it's
bar.
It's worth it to hear you tell me that you're so sorry.
Billy is not only our assistant webmaster, but he's the president of his student government.
Yes, I am.
Over at a school. Also, editor in the school newspaper, the Buena Vista Informer.
So obviously a popular guy.
But not so popular that he has a prom date. And the prom is coming up May 20th.
Yes.
And you're going to need a date. So one of your sister's friends is who you're interested in.
Yeah, Kim Watts. She's my...
Sounds hot. She hot?
She is hot.
She's a little bit older?
She is a little bit older.
How old is she?
I think she's 20.
20?
Yeah.
Now that's a big difference, 17 and 20.
Yeah.
But you think you're up to the challenge?
I am definitely up to
Billy
it.
Billy shooting high here.
Good. She's on line one. Kim?
Hi.
How are you? Sound cute.
I'm fine. How are you?
Now, how long have you known Billy?
Since middle school. Yeah, my dad took him and his sister home.
Well, you may be 20, and Billy...
I'm not 20. I'm 19.
Oh, you're 19? Just a couple years older than Billy. But
I
Billy
like her baby doll voice.
Is an old soul, and you sound like a Barbie doll. So I think you're younger. I mean, Billy, let's be honest, when you've loved and lost like Billy has over here, when you've seen the world, you know what I mean? I mean, chronologically, his driver's license says 17 years of age, but anyone who knows Billy knows he's an old soul. He's been to hell and back, this kid.
Literally.
Yes, literally. Literally.
To paint the picture quickly for people who know Clint Eastwood's movies of the late 70s, early 80s, Billy looked very much like the main bad guy, the biker guy from The Black Widows. The main guy, he looks like a young version of,
when
of
he,
that guy from
when
the
he
Clint Eastwood.
IMDb's that guy's going to really misspell your name.
Any which way you can, well, every which way but loose, yes.
There's a picture of me at myspace.com/WJPM.
So if you want to know what Billy looks like, that's where you go. Yeah, why bother finding a reasonable facsimile when you can have the real McCoy? So Billy's interested in taking you to the prom, Kim. That's.
Oh, wow.
It's probably not a great sign. Would you like to ask her?
He's the president of the student government.
Yeah, it's going to translate into a ton of tail.
Yeah. His assistant webmaster. You know what? He just got promoted. He's now the webmaster.
Oh, my.
Hot, huh?
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah, it probably goes like this. I think it goes professional athlete, webmaster, and then rock star. I think for most women, that's about the pecking order.
Oh,
yeah,
rock
Ace,
stars.
You've done the lion's share of the work here. I think you bring in the closer now. Bring in Righty, Billy Moses out of the pen to close the deal. Why don't you do the ass?
Take the windbreaker off, Billy, and give her your best pitch.
Hi, Kim.
Hi.
I was wondering if you would like to go to prom with me.
I would love to.
Wow, look at him.
That's great.
That's great.
Now, I don't want you to think that this is just, a free ride in a limo and a bump of Tootski in the girl's bath. This has to be more than that. This has to be, a little canoodling and a little cuddling.
She'll have the time of her life.
What's that, Kim?
Cuddle with him?
A little cuddling. Perhaps he'll get you the very classy wrist corsage.
Oh, I love those.
I got my lady an ankle corsage.
Nice.
Yeah.
I don't want to move too fast or anything like that. I think this is exciting that you two kids are going to have a nice time at the prom. Would you say right now, Kim, that there's a chance for romance?
No.
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 No, maybe, though.
I can't date him.
Why not?
Because he's my best friend's little brother.
You could be lovers, though.
He's not legal yet. I can't even touch him.
If Ace Young was your best friend's little brother, do you think you'd make an exception?
Who's that?
The guy from American Idol?
I don't watch American Idol.
Evidently.
I'm too cool for that.
Wow.
Billy's heart is broken, by the way. You see his
Billy,
face?
What do you look like, Kim?
You can check on MySpace. Oh,
what a time we're living in. There's no more describe yourself. It's just hop on the computer. You want to see nude pictures of me?
I was curious, too, how Kim looks. Maybe Billy has a description.
He just wants to touch my boobs.
Ooh. Where are we at in that department? D-cup, perhaps?
Yeah.
Billy, high five, buddy.
She's foxy, Billy.
Yeah.
Billy, here's what happens. You go to the prom, you take her for some nice food, couple of belts, you show her the time of her life, then her story changes on the romance.
All right, so you'll go to the prom with Billy, but no romantic interest.
I'll dance with him because I like to dance.
That's nice that you qualified it that way. You wouldn't do it because you're a fan of Bill's. You just like dancing. I want to go on that web. I want to go find a picture of you.
Yeah, let's find that. But also in the meantime, AdamCarolla.com. This had medium success. Kim said yes, but there's not going to be romance. It doesn't sound like. But I say let's wait and see. But the point is, AdamCarolla.com, if you go there, if you're having trouble asking that special someone to the prom, let Carolla do it for you.
Yeah, I'll call
him
up.
He'll close the deal.
You're one for one right now.
Go on there, log on, you give your stuff, you give the information, the phone numbers and stuff, and
Kim,
he'll call him up for
Kim, do you have a boyfriend now?
No, I do not.
Perfect. Why not?
I don't know.
Why not just at least leave it open? You know what I mean? Why decide in advance?
Okay.
Perhaps you'll be swayed by the magic of the night.
Yeah.
Doesn't sound too promising. How much do you weigh? Give us a description of you.
I can't tell you.
What do you think?
We're going to see your pitch, and then we're going to have to guess. When we go on MySpace, we're going to have to guess about your weight.
Give us your measurements.
No, I don't know.
Well, what celebrity do you look like?
No one.
Mm-hmm.
What's your MySpace page?
You sound like a delight, by the way.
Thank you.
I understand why Billy's so enamored with you. Couldn't be the jugs. It's got to be the personality.
That's all we know about her now.
It's everything.
And her love of dance.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You describe her, Billy.
She's hot.
Yes. That's not
a description. Color of eyes, anything?
She has, like, curly hair. Like, not really curly, but like...
Why don't you speak up, Billy?
Please.
Kind of like curly hair that's wavy and...
Say no more.
Yeah.
I now would recognize her from a distance.
You paint a wonderful picture.
Yep. Wow.
A richly hued description.
Wow, you should work as one of those courtroom sketch artists, because that was vivid. Talk about detail. I feel as if I know her now.
This is some collection. That, on the other hand, you have Tad over here trying to find her on MySpace, but doesn't know how to log on to the computer.
Kiss my butt, I'm trying to find her.
Uh-oh.
A picture is worth 1,000 words.
You know? I agree. All right, here. Kim?
Uh-huh.
I got to tell you, I know you'll technically go with Billy to the prom, uh-huh. and Billy's probably desperate enough to still go with you, but I don't know. I don't know if we should let him.
Maybe you should veto this one, Ace, for the good of Billy.
I am. I'm not going to give it my stamp of approval.
Why not?
Well,
your attitude stinks, lady.
That's right.
Uh-oh.
That's right.
To high heaven. You have no interest in Billy. You're You're only going there to dance.
I have to be in love with him or something?
Well, you should at least be open to the prospect of, you know, little kissy-kissy.
Okay.
Dave, would you like to add anyone to your jerk report?
I think Kim just made the jerk report.
Are you serious?
Unless once I see her picture, I may change my tune.
We're looking it up right now. Billy and I are on MySpace.
Kim, I'm putting you on hold. Billy, I forbid you from going to the prom with Kim.
What? You forbid it, or she's not going to be the backup plan? That's how she deserves to be treated, like a backup plan.
I'm going to turn the conversation serious for a moment and say this.
Listen up, Billy.
Billy, you idolize me, right?
Idolize. Yes.
You know that everything comes out of my mouth
is genius.
Literally spun gold.
Yes.
And you should be hanging on every syllable.
Literally.
100%.
Okay. I've loved and lost. I've seen a lot in my 41 years of life. And I'll tell you this. Once you start compromising, it's a very slippery slope. Your self-esteem. You know, they talk about pot as a stepping stone drug.
Gateway.
Gateway drug. That's what the sort of compromise. I know she doesn't like me. I know she's not into me, but I'll call her back anyway and beg her for a date. And maybe she'll take enough pity just to be seen at a movie theater with me. Once you do that, you start sliding down Crap Hill and you can never recover. Let me explain what it's like on the backside of Crap Hill. Slippery and no branches to grab to stop your free fall. I say better you
Diarrhea
date somebody...
Valley.
Better you date somebody who's interested in you, even if she's a step down or two from the beautiful and bosomy Kim. Perhaps you leave Kim to me.
That's why I'm waiting for the picture before I finalize her entry into the jerk report.
Take a stand now, and all the young people listening, take a stand. Don't compromise. Better you should stay home than go to the prom with one who's not interested in you. I made that mistake. That's right. The young Adam Carolla took Jenny Hoover, the beautiful Jenny Hoover, to the prom. She had no interest in me, but it didn't matter. I took her anyway, and then began my long and lengthy slide down Crap Mountain.
That's a funny thing, because I took Chrissy Estorino to mine, and she finished the night by making out with Patrick Joyce.
That's right. I saw you on Crap Mountain. I slid right past Damashek when I was 18, yes.
This just in, I've seen Kim, and she's pretty.
Mm-hmm. Any cleavage? Any cleavage there?
You can't tell from the shot, but apparently Billy's told us she's well endowed.
All right. Kim.
Aww.
I'm sorry.
She's got pouty eyes and lips. So
I'll not let my young protege, Billy, slide down Crap Mountain.
Okay.
You're now out.
You happy with yourself now, Kim?
And as a matter of fact, Kim, Billy told me he wrote something down on a steno pad and slid it over to me that he thought he was too good for you. And
wow.
He had much bigger fish to fry than one Kim Watts. So he's moving on. And he actually said he was a rambling man.
That's not true.
What's that mean?
Okay. Oh. Wow. What a day we're living in where a young woman does not know college. When a man threatens to ramble. Imagine that. When my young son, Ace Hollywood Corolla, tells his young gal, it's rambling time, and she wants to know what that means. Is that a dish? Is that a new workout? No, bitch, I'm rambling. I'm sorry, I don't know what that is. Kim doesn't know what it is to ramble. Rambling is when a man moves on, and that's what Billy's doing.
I'm going to be so depressed.
Yeah.
I'm going to go cut myself.
Please.
Uh-oh, just a feel?
So be it.
So be it.
She wants to play games with Billy's heart. She gets what she deserves.
Don't do that, Kim. I will not let him slide down Crab Mountain. Billy, we'll do better than this.
Billy will find you a date, and if you need to find the date and you don't ask, go to adamcarolla.com and let Ace ask for it.
That's okay.
That's right. And here's the thing. If we don't find you a prom date, I will don the wig and heels and escort you to the prom. And believe me, you'll get to at least third base with
Adam,
me.
I would go to prom with you.
At least. And if you got some blow, home run.
Home run.
All right. We'll take ourselves a break. We'll be back after this.
He's a funny brother, this man of color. He's got five sons from four different mothers. The things he says will mess with your head. From Vegas, he's the Ed.
What did he?
The Ed.
Hello.
Yes, there you are.
Hey, Adam.
Ed from Vegas. Ed, you do our Desperate Housewives review every week for us.
Yeah, I watch it.
Mm-hmm. Did you watch yesterday?
Yep, I did. And you know what? We got some trouble.
Mm-mm.
Now, I think you need to talk to them people at CBS. Okay. Because you know what they did?
Yeah. It's ABC, I believe, but it's tough with the initials.
Right. Mm-hmm. They're so similar.
Mm-hmm.
They made a review show. They're going to put me out of business.
Mm-hmm. They did one of those shows where they just look back on.
Best of.
Yeah, I didn't like it. I said, what in the world? I said, oh, no, they didn't listen to Adam's show.
Mm-hmm.
They done got the idea from you, see?
Mm, yeah.
So they recapped everything that's happened. I mean, it's good for people who don't get to watch it. But
redundant, if you listen to the Ed every week, right?
Yeah, it sure is.
Mm-hmm.
So they showed, you know, with the Gabriella and her husband, they did show one part that I must have been eating some peanuts or something, because they showed a part where her husband was going to annul their marriage.
Mm.
It wasn't going to be married no more.
Yeah.
So that was a part that I hadn't seen. So I guess, you know, a lot of the stuff everybody already seen, and it wasn't too good of a show this time. I hope they don't do it again.
Now, the Ed, just to go back for a second, so you don't watch TV and eat peanuts simultaneously?
Well, I had to go to the refrigerator and get them.
Oh, I see.
Peanuts
in the fridge.
Well, I know what I'm saying, in the kitchen.
All right.
Yeah, in the kitchen.
No, it's true. If you eat loud food like bagel chips when you're trying to watch something, you can't hear a thing.
It's true.
It's weird that popcorn caught on as big as it did. And if you're a mouth breather like I am, people hear me eating the popcorn in the theater. It's like the retarded guy with the huge bucket. People warning me not to wear it as a hat as I leave. It's not a cap, son.
Well, Adam, I heard that you mean mouth my son, and I say yes to you.
Well, I say nay. I mean yay.
Ed, your son called in, the good one, too, right?
Right.
The one?
Well, he was living at home.
He ain't the good one.
I see.
No. I was stayed over at the neighbor lady's house the other night, and then I came home early in the morning, and he told me, I called your friends.
Mm.
And I said, what you calling for? You don't call my people. You stay, get your own friends. You don't do what I'm doing. You always want to do what I'm trying to do.
Yeah.
That's nice. He admires you.
Well, the apple doesn't fall very far from the Ed tree, apparently. Ed, you're staying with a neighbor lady friend, huh?
Yeah, I go over there to her house a couple nights a week. She's a widow.
Oh, I see.
So I've been seeing her. She made me some brownies one day because she listened to the show.
Ah.
And you know what she told me?
Mm.
She said, Ed. Well, she called me Edward. She said, Edward, I really like you on the show, and I think you've made it.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
You've arrived.
And then you made it with her.
Yeah.
Well, I did. Well, my son always says, Daddy, did you hit it?
And oh, yeah. That's what they say.
Well, I said, I did my thing. That's all I can say.
Sure, you packed that brownie
match. She's a nice lady.
Yeah.
Yep, she's the lady. She lived about two doors down.
Right.
My son told me I should go live with her. I said, well, you keep talking trash, I will.
Well, the ad knows what he's doing when it comes to ladies. Yes. He doesn't wind up with four sons by accident.
Hey, the ad, we're running real late here for news and sports, okay. So we got to cut a little bit short. But we do thank you for not only the update on Desperate Housewives, but on your own social life.
Yes.
Well, hopefully it'll be a good show next week, and we can talk about the show, because all this other nonsense is just, you know...
Thank
people don't like that.
Right. Ed Miller, thank you, from Las Vegas. Now, it is time for Teresa Strasser and the news.
Well, this probably isn't news to you if you tried to fill up your gas tank this weekend. Gas prices have jumped an average of almost a quarter per gallon in the last 2 weeks, according to a survey released yesterday. Self-serve regular is averaging $2.91 a gallon. Drivers in San Diego are paying the most at an average of $3.12 a gallon for regular.
Mm-hmm. I've talked about this before, but it bears repeating. Now's the time just to jack up the prices and get off our ass. Everybody has been paying far. I mean, we pay the least just about out of any country, except for, I guess, China. God knows what the hell they're doing over there. But a few things. We're dependent on oil. We never stop talking about it. And if you've been around long enough, that's all you've been hearing. I mean, for those of us who remember way back in the day, waiting in lines, mm-hmm. odd, even license plate yep. numbers, oil embargoes, OPEC
Jimmy
nations.
Carter administration. Right.
Yes, this stuff has been going on for more than 30 years. We've been talking about it. When are we going to get more efficient cars? What about these hybrid cars? So on and so forth. No one's ever going to do it as long as gas is cheap. That's the deal. This is what we do. We force people to do what we want them to do by creating consequences or raising the price. This is how you get mass amounts of people to do what they... Imagine if everything else was, look, you know, come into the stadium, we're on the honor system, put whatever you think is fair into the kitty. The club would be out of business in the first season, right? I mean, this is why... Or pay your income taxes, pay what you think is fair. Pay right. what you think is right. If you're like me and you don't use the library very often, you don't call 911 very often, then just put in what you think is fair. It would never work. We need to raise the price of gas to $7 a gallon. If you want to drive the Hummer, if you want to drive the Corvette, if you need the 5.6 liter V8 engine that puts out 500 horsepower and gets you 14 miles a gallon, so be it. It's $7 a gallon. For those of you whiners who are complaining out there, don't worry. We're sending a van over to your house, and we'll put you on a light rail, and we'll take you to a detention camp. Oh, no, wait a minute. I spoke too much. We'll take you to work. We'll take you to work. And that's how it'll work. You want people to ride the buses? Raise the prices, get people onto the bus. Make the bus for free. I'll pay for you to ride the bus. What are the biggest problems we have? We have congestion.
Traffic.
It takes everyone an hour and a half to get to get 20 miles to work. What else?
Pollution.
The ozone. Oh, fluorocarbons. Oh, the greenhouse effect. All we do is try to get people out of their automobiles, but we just ask them. Hey, how about you share a ride to work? Hey, we're doing a little van pool. Sign up in the bathroom in the hallway. Just go ahead and put your name under Big Tad's there. And Big Tad will swing by and he'll pick up Bill, get Gayboard out Bill, and then he'll swing by Damashek's house. One toot on the horn and you come running out. How about that?
Usually, yeah. Usually you're more conservative with some of these fiscal things. But this would be great. $7. Then that money, $7 a gallon, would go to make the buses and public
right.
transportation free.
Yes, and imagine, here's what it does. It gets you $3 in change, $3.50, $4 per gallon. Every gallon of gas that I purchase goes to get Ozzy in the van and goes to get the van to pick Ozzy up at his place and take Ozzy up to my house so I can yell at him and he can drink my beer. And then the van will pick him up and take him back to his place again. And the money will go into building rail systems. And it will go into... And for those of you who are complaining that it's $7 an hour, don't complain. You're riding for free.
And the funding Priuses.
That's right. Research and development of experimental fuels or alternative fuel sources, and to help the poor get around. Now I got a wide open freeway, $7 a gallon. I drive whatever I want. If I want to drive a Sherman tank, that's my business. That's how you incentivize people. That's how you get them out of their cars.
Yep.
Right. And look, again, if you don't want to drive, fine. Don't drive. $7 is too much. Don't do it. It's a privilege, not a right, as they always said at the DMV. That's my plan. That would work. Otherwise, we'll never have fuel-efficient cars. We'll never have the alternative fuel sources. And we'll never have public transportation, and no one will use it. That's all.
Price people out of their cars and into the carpools. That's what you're saying.
If you want them to do something as a society, don't ask them to do it. Create incentive, and that will get them to do it. The incentive has to be either here's a dollar to do this, or, I mean, like, let's put it this way. If a guy's just sitting in the sidewalk and you want him to move, you either have to say, as a society, I'll give you a dollar to move, or I'll throw your ass in jail
right
to move. But if you just said, hey, I'd like you to move, he's going to say, F you, I'm comfortable here. That's how it is. Give him a dollar, get him to move. I'll give him my dollar. They can move. And it'll be happy sailing for me on the freeway. That's right. In the Ferrari, scarf in the wind, sunglasses on, listening to Herb Albert, laughing. Laughing and sipping champagne from a Magnum between my legs.
That seems a little mean-spirited. But the larger point, though.
Yeah, yes. Thank you.
Point is well taken.
It would work.
In entertainment news on The Sopranos last night, Christopher and his buddy try to pitch Sir Ben Kingsley their movie idea, which is described as a combination between The Godfather and The Ring. Here's Christopher, his buddy, talking to Kingsley.
Oh, as ever, it's script dependent.
Oh, we got a sensational writer, J.T. Dole.
I'm embarrassed. I haven't heard of him.
He's from TV. Nash Bridges, Hooper Man, Law & Order, The SUV.
So there's a script?
We wanted to surmise your interest and then tailor the part to your specificities. No one plays a tough, ruthless, hard-hearted prick like you do.
You got it down. Trust me.
I take that as quite a compliment.
Ben Kingsley passes on the role.
Yeah. I'd say two things about that episode quickly.
Yes.
Ben Kingsley won. That was a preposterous thing that these two mobsters get a meeting with Ben Kingsley. I say this, and I think we should really try to do this. Adam Carolla, you could not get a meeting to talk about a movie script with Ben Kingsley. Let's see how long it takes for you to get a meeting with Ben Kingsley. Let's really try this on the air. One. And two, the other thing is Chris Moltisanti becomes enamored with the idea of the you know, the gift baskets,
the freebies. Yes. Yeah.
All the freebies. So he ends up punching Lauren Bacall
to get her gift basket worth $30,000.
Probably the most ridiculous moment in Sopranos history. Funny, yeah. Yes, but pretty goddamn ridiculous.
All right. Everyone's a critic. Kingsley's online too. He wants to hear what I have to say. By the way, so Dave, you've been wrong again today. All right.
I'm Teresa Strasser. That's the news.
Hello. We gotta go to break.
Dave,
we gotta go to break. We're running really late.
No way. We're doing the sports.
We're doing sports. People want to hear it. We got some instant matchmaking. Fish Tank, do you want to hear the sports? Well, they do. The people
producer
have spoken.
Says no. We don't have
the
time.
People, let me just say this: the Clippers play tonight at 7:30 against the Nuggets at the Staples Center. Lakers lost yesterday.
Everyone's one a creep.
All right, we're going to take a break. Samantha Daniels is coming in here. She's the matchmaker, the date matchmaker of the stars. I added that. Sounds better.
It does.
She'll be in here. We'll talk to her about her multi-million-dollar industry after this.
They seem to come and go. Yeah. But this one intrigues all of us. Her dad does porn stars taxes. She shot down Jerron's advances. We think she might be bi-curious. She's intern Larissa.
Wow. Sweet Melissa. By the way, there's a hot chick we need from commercials. That singular wireless commercial where the fat schlub drives the GTO from somewhere in Louisiana to San Francisco.
From Boston to San Francisco.
Yeah, he's going to go be with his hot chick that looks like Courtney Cox.
Right.
Yeah, he's doing that thing where he has the fern hanging out of the back of the convertible and he's driving across country.
And I found another woman we got to find out, commercial woman, is on the Gillette Shave commercial. She wears like a lab coat that's very short and black boots, and she delivers the goods in a briefcase. She says, the goods are in, and she flips it open, but I'm not looking at the goods. I'm looking at her goods.
All right, we'll find, add them to the list. Makes me angry when schlubby guys get to be with hot chicks. Yeah. I don't like that, unless you're in show business. Samantha Daniels, good to meet you.
Hi.
The Diary of a Modern Matchmaker is the book. Samantha, by the way, is the inspiration for Mismatch, the NBC show, the former NBC show starring Alicia Silverstone. Yes? You're the inspiration for that, right?
I was the inspiration.
High-end matchmaker, would you call yourself?
Yes, I own a company called Samantha's Table, and it's in New York and in Los Angeles, and I work with very high-end people.
Mm-hmm.
You're a pimp.
Any celebrities we may have
heard? No, a madam, please.
Any celebs we may have heard of?
I work with a lot of celebrities, but the service is very discreet, so I can't tell you any of them.
Mm-hmm.
Tell us one.
I can't.
Charlie Sheen.
I can't.
Now, why would a celebrity need your help? I mean, shouldn't a celebrity be able to walk into any popular bistro or bar and pick himself up a lady?
Well, the problem is that a lot of times people are hitting on them, but they're not the quality, the type of person that they're looking for. So a lot of celebrities will go on talk shows and actually say that they sit home Saturday night alone because they can't meet someone.
Yeah, they always say that. I know. Mm-hmm. The supermodel who was made fun of because she was so tall and she was a tomboy. Yeah, you were in Eastern Europe and then went to Japan to model at age 13. How much tomboy living did you
do? With celebrities, it's feast or famine a lot, because a lot of times they're in this great relationship and they get tons of press and everyone's so happy for them, and then they break up and all of these sleaze bags are going after them, and it's all these bad relationships, all this rebound situations, and then they just want to sit home and be by themselves for a while, and they want to meet someone but they don't know how. Mm-hmm. So then they would hire
That's
someone
where you
like
come
me.
In.
Exactly.
How much does it cost?
Costs a lot.
Really?
Yes.
Wow.
Well, now, but how do you know? I mean, when do you get paid? When you make a match? When you
I get paid before, during, and after. And then they have to name their firstborn Samantha or Sam.
Wow. Really? So if I was
that was a joke.
I know. If I was to use, but look, if I laughed at every attempt at humor on the show, I'd be raw by the time I got. No.
I'd appreciate it.
Yeah, I mean, I don't do it for Dave. I won't do it for the guests. So if I wanted to hire you, how much would you need just to get started?
You personally?
Yeah.
A lot.
Oh, wow.
Is there like a money back guarantee? I guarantee that you get to at least third base or money back.
Yeah, it doesn't really work that way. You pay
seriously,
you pay
how much?
Up front $425 to sit down with me for a consultation. Mm-hmm. You sit down with me for an hour. You tell me about who you've dated in the past, why it hasn't worked, and who you're looking for going forward. Mm-hmm. And I give you some dating tips, and you get a copy of my book, Matchbook.
Well, what are some of the dating tips? Because Jerron is to your right, and so is Larissa, and they're going out tonight. So what should you say to them?
Well, first of all, do you know where you're going?
Yes.
Okay. Drinks or dinner?
We're going for both.
Not to the Boneyard. That's all I know so far.
The Bone Zone.
So you're going for drinks and dinner?
Yes.
And you have a good arsenal of conversation topics that you're going to talk about when you get there?
I can think of something eventually.
Yeah. Off the cuff?
You should plan this sort of
like
thing?
Like read the newspaper today and have stuff up his sleeve?
Yeah, I think that you need to always be prepared to have the backup conversation, because let's say there's a lull. You've been talking, and you all work together, so you see each other every day, and maybe at, like, hour two, you've got nothing left.
Yeah, you're only going to be able to kill.
There's going to be a second
There's
hour.
Only going to be so much Adams and A-hole conversation. All right, hold on.
I'll see you later on.
Hold on a second. We have to take a break. I'm sorry. Where did the time go? Well, Samantha Daniels is here. She's a professional matchmaker. So more tips and to-dos for not only young Jerron, but all you single folks listening after this.
You're listening to The Adam Carolla Show. Check him out online at adamcarolla.com.
There you go. Don't bother calling. We're almost out of time. Samantha Daniels is here. Matchbook, The Diary of a Modern Day Matchmaker. She's an expert. We're not. few more tips.
SamanthasTable.com.
For young Jaron.
That's my company.
Right. SamanthasTable.com.
All right, so let's see. So first of all, if you had asked me, I would have said drinks first and then maybe dinner because it's a lot of pressure up front to commit to drinks and dinner. You're better off just going for drinks. Number two, when she shows up, if she looks hot or if she doesn't look hot, you should compliment her because women love compliments, brings a smile to their face, and it makes them really like you. So that would be another one. Thirdly, you need to tip well. I don't care if it's the last penny in your piggy bank. Women notice how much you tip, and if you tip well, and if the waitress gives that awful look on her face, I can't believe you tipped me so poorly. Women notice that.
Oh, I thought it was the date if you got a handy. All right, I'm sorry. I'm out of line.
Same thing holds right. true, though.
You want to try to be really charming. So when you take her home, if you drove her and you pull up to her building, you want to make sure you wait until she gets into the door. A lot of guys, they drop the girl off and she's not even out of the door and she hasn't even closed it and he's flying off. Mm-hmm. It's important to kind of see that she got in so she's safe. A woman notices things like
I would
that.
Always wait in the van until she just stepped across the threshold and then I bum rush her with the chloroform, whatever I use, and the duct tape. And now I got an evening.
And if the evening goes really well and some sort of sexual activity happens, whether it's the real deal or something close to the real deal, you need to call the next day and do some follow-up. If I don't care what's going on for you the next day, how busy you are, if you were that lucky to have that going on with her, you need to call her the next day. Or if you see her, you need to be really nice and you need to make it comfortable.
Sorry about the herpes.
So what time should I call then?
Yeah.
What time should I call you tomorrow?
All right. We are unfortunately way out of time. Samantha Daniels, thank you. We'll have you back for an extended period. I'm sorry we just got pushed a little bit today. Young couple, Jaron and Larissa.
Young couple, good luck.
You guys are going out tonight. We'll get a full report tomorrow. Keep Samantha's words and let them echo in your head as you date. The Diary of a Modern Day Matchmaker is the name of the book. Or Samantha, how do you say this? Say it again, Dave.
SamanthasTable.com.
SamanthasTable.com is where you'd go, sorry. All right, I want to thank... we're out of time. I'll thank these guys tomorrow. So, until next time, this is Adam saying mahalo.